I'm muting. Give me a countdown.
You're listening to Fade to Black with your host, Jimmy Church, on the Dark Matter Radio Network. Don't run and hide. Don't be afraid. Don't turn away any longer. The truth will set you free. And now, your host, the captain of conspiracy, the prince of paranormal. This ain't your daddy's radio network show. This is Jimmy Church, Fade to Black.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Here we go. This is Fade to Black. It is Wednesday, March 26th, 85 days into the new year. As always, we are live from the JP Motorsports Studios right here in Burbank, California. For KJCR and the Dark Matter Radio Network, I am your host, Jimmy Church. Kicking off another week. Let's get it cracking. Let's go. That's cracking number one. A big salute to the proud men and women in uniform all around the world, fighting the good fight for us. Without them, there is no me, there is no you, there is no us, and you can't hear me right now. Think about it. Let's go. I'm ready. Today, Aerosmith frontman Steven Tyler, 66 years old. You can kind of tell, can't you? With my birthdays, who I am. Leonard Nimoy is 83 years old. Actor James Caan, yeah, 74. Check this out. Alan Arkin is 80. And I'll top it all off with that Darwinian dude, an atheist, Richard Dawkins is 73. Love to get him on this show. That would just be ugly. Our dead guy birthday today is soul man Teddy Pendergrass. He was born on this day in 1950 and died tragically in 2010. He was great. Follow us on Twitter. At J Church Radio, Facebook. I'm going to talk about Facebook here in a few minutes. YouTube. Get it done. Follow, like, subscribe. You know what to do. Go do it. Tonight, I'm going to open up the lines with Jay Weidner. Be taking your calls. 323-825-5045. That is the call-in number. You can email throughout the show, as always. Jimmy@JimmyChurchRadio.com. You can do it all over the website. You can do it in your browser. Do what you got to do. But we do use non-NSA, specially encrypted servers here. If you want to be safe, just go to the contact page. Jimmy@JimmyChurchRadio.com. The bumper music. I was talking to some of our fans out there, some listeners in Holland, and about Doug Aldrich today. And they're listening right now. So anyway, talking about Adrian Vandenberg, which was strange because he was in Whitesnake. And Vandenberg, Adrian, you remember that song, Burning Heart? He's got a new band out. I'm going to put the links up. Big fan of Adrian. Anyway, music tonight, as always, is Doug Aldrich. Tomorrow night, we are going to do a time travel show. We're going to have the man himself, Ronald Mallett from UConn. And I got to tell you, if there's anybody out there that can answer my questions about time travel, it is Ronald Mallett. And we will have him on tomorrow night. And his team made it to the Sweet 16, UConn. Here you go. I was talking to him about it yesterday. He didn't even know. He's like, Jimmy, I don't follow sports. I thought that was hilarious. And Friday night, we're going to do the ET Let's Talk show with Daniel Sheehan and another special guest. You're going to check that out. That'll be Friday night. It's going to be really cool. ET Let's Talk. ETLetstalk.org. Okay, what's going on? What's going on in the world right now? It's kind of crazy. 5 days after our last show on Friday, and we are no closer to solving anything with the Malaysian missing plane. And all of the satellite photos, all of the debris, everything that has been sighted hasn't been found. Send out boats, send out planes, nothing. Big pieces, 75, 78, 79-foot chunks of debris out there in the ocean, and nothing has been found. They go out, they photograph, they go out, it's not there. They go out, they photograph, they report it, they go out, it's not there. And I'm getting closer and closer to going to a dark place as to what happened to this plane. And everything is pointing at the pilot now. And again, we really, really honestly don't know anything. It's all speculation. Every last bit of it. We know nothing. We don't even know if the plane went down in the South Indian Ocean. We don't know. Half pings, six pings. We know nothing. And I would have thought after 9/11, every single plane on planet Earth was tracked. There are crazy stories that go on the net outside of the United States that we don't get here. You have to search for it. But I'm just wondering if that plane was brought down. Hijacking. Plane was taken over. We knew about it, and maybe we did something about it. As tragic and as crazy as that sounds, that is a possibility. And that's what I'm talking about. It's putting my mind in a dark place. It just seems that the Malaysians know something, the United States knows something, the Chinese know something, and nobody is talking. I don't even know if they're talking with each other. It's absolutely bizarre, but we are no closer. None. Absolutely none. Tomorrow, we can wake up, check the news, it'll be the same. All right. What else is going on? Marscoin.org. Check this out. As if you weren't Bitcoin to death last week. Marscoin.org. Check it out. Yep. Mars now has its own currency. You can go to Marscoin.org. You can download your very own Marscoin wallet for free. And get yourself some Mars currency. Because when we eventually settle on Mars, they're going to need some do-re-mi. Think about it. They need some dash. It's going to be Mars coin. And check it out. I'm not kidding. I was over there today. Now, Mars coins right now, I think they're trading for about a penny each. So you can go get a free Mars coin wallet and go and buy a buttload of Mars coins, stuff them in your virtual wallet, keep them on your computer, and then when you need to buy something on Mars, go and get you some right now. Marscoin.org. It's very cool. And as I'm saying these words, I almost feel like I'm in a daydream, but it's real. You can go there right now. Marscoin.org. Have you heard about Mark Dice? What happened to Mark Dice? We contacted him a couple of weeks ago. I would love to get him on the show. And he's a pretty crazy guy. Now, when you get him on a subject, New World Order, Rothschilds, you know, Bilderberg. You get him on that subject and everything is cool. He's very smart, very knowledgeable. But he's also got some out there thoughts too, as well. Well, those out there thoughts got his YouTube channel and his backup YouTube channel shut down. And with apparently with the help and thanks to Alex Jones, somehow somebody influenced YouTube to get those channels back up. So Mark Dice is now back up and running. And if you're not a Mark Dice fan, I am. I think he's he speaks his mind, and it's all about free speech. But he's back up and running, and it's a crazy story. You need to go and again, you know, I'm about freedom of speech. I'm about speaking your mind. It doesn't matter where it comes from. That's what this country is based on. And for Mark to get shut down just because he is outspoken is wrong. But it looks like Alex Jones came to the rescue. They circled the wagons. What else? This is just a crazy story. And I did a couple of tests, and I know that you saw it. But the free marketing gravy train is over on Facebook. It's done. Time Magazine reports now that Facebook users are down to 6% with their post. Down from 12% in October. Now think about what I am saying. You've got 5,000 friends on Facebook. You got 100 friends on Facebook, but you make your post and it goes out. Facebook, you've noticed it trimming back. Friends that you know are out there aren't seeing your post and they're not responding back. And you were wondering about it. Facebook is now, and this is from Facebook directly. That's it. They cut it down to 30%, went down to 12. Now it's down to 6. And in the next couple of months, according to Facebook, it's going to be down to 1 to 2%. And they pick and choose where it goes and who reads. Now, what that means for friends and fans and customers of companies, that if you want people to read your stuff, you want to get it out there, you're going to have to pay for it. That whole free thing is gone. I remember when I first started doing radio, as, you know, not that far back, but maybe 2010-ish, I remember sending out stuff on Facebook and getting reactions, and it was great because you would touch all kinds of nerves, and every type of person would read it. Pro, con, indifferent, and you would get these passionate threads going instantly. Those days are gone. Now you can send out a post. I sent out a post. I have about 2,300 friends on my personal page. So I sent out a post just to check. Nothing. Well, something. But they have cut it back, and I just noticed over the last year how it was going. And not only with me, but everybody else saying the same things. But now it's official. And I think Facebook is looking at things the wrong way. Now they're looking at profits next year of $10.8 billion. Right now it's $6 billion. And they're getting those profits from selling. That whole free thing is gone. Those days are gone. And it just, now it looks like it's a Twitter world. You said, that's, and I think Facebook, if they don't watch it, it's going to go the direction of MySpace. And I'm not joking. They should just go back to what made them great in the first place, that you could just talk to everybody and get that passion going. But it's gone. Tomorrow, Mirage Men makes its debut. You can still pre-order over at jimmychurchradio.com, but tomorrow's the day. And that is something that will not disappoint. So you can pre-order right now at jimmychurchradio.com. Tomorrow is the premiere, and I just can't wait to get to just, I want everybody's comments. I want to see the email. I want to get the threads going on the forums, because that is a disturbing documentary, because it speaks the truth. And tomorrow is the premiere. All right, next. Oh, I wanted to say really quick to everybody, I miss, you know who I miss? I miss William Bill Moore. Miss that guy. Over the last couple of months, I just have been going through a Bill Moore fix. Going and finding his old broadcast and listening to him. That was a guy, talk about freedom of speech. That was a guy that said it like it is. And if you caught a really good show on a really good subject, he was spot on the money. That guy was on pitch, in tune. Miss Bill Moore. Man. Okay. So, anyway, last night, I go and I dig up. We're going to bring on Jay Weidner here in a couple of minutes. And I happen to find, of all things, a Bill Moore show on Fulcanelli. And I listened to that, and it was like a two-parter. And I just got to say, I miss Bill Moore. That was a man that that was blazing trails. And if you ever get a chance, go check out, just go to YouTube, dig up some old Bill Moore stuff. And his intro on the show, his music, I'm thinking of theft. One of these days you're going to dial in to Fade to Black and you're going to hear a Bill Moore intro. That man was the man. All right, when we come back, right after this, we'll take a quick break. Jay Weidner is our guest, and we're going to do a full night of Fulcanelli, Mysteries of the Cathedrals, The Cross of Hendaye, and a bunch of other really cool stuff. Maybe some Stanley Kubrick. I'll be back right after this. Don't go anywhere.
Listening to Jimmy Church Fade to Black on the Dark Matter Radio Network.
What's up, revolutionaries? It's me, Jimmy Church. Do you have an IRS or state tax issue? Well, I did, and I called national tax experts. My problems were fixed, done, fini, and man, I gotta tell you, it was a relief. National tax experts are a recognized tax office that services clients in all 50 states. It doesn't matter where you live. Give them a call. I'm telling you, they take the time to understand each and every client's individual financial status as well as their financial goals. And that's exactly what you need, my brother, when you're taking on the evil three-letter. So, seriously, give them a call today at 1-877-909-5444. Again, 1-877-909-5444, or go check out their website, www.nattaxexperts.com. That's NATTAXEXPERTS.com. Tell them Jimmy sent you.
This is KJCR at JimmyChurchRadio.com.
On the Dark Matter.
All right, let's go. Fade to Black. Shoot us an email right now to jimmy@jimmychurchradio.com. Any questions for Jay? You got to pierce the veil of the show producers. Make it good. Get it in here. Follow us on Twitter at JChurchRadio. All right, let's go. Let's get it cracking. Here we go. Jay Weidner, called by Wired Magazine an authority on the hermetic and alchemical, I've said that too many times today, traditions, and erudite conspiracy hunter. Jay Weidner is a renowned author, filmmaker, and hermetic scholar, considered to be a modern-day Indiana Jones. For his ongoing worldwide quest to find clues to mankind's spiritual destiny via ancient societies and artifacts, his body of work offers great insight into the circumstances that have led to the current global crisis. He is the director of the powerful and insightful documentaries Kubrick's Odyssey, Infinity, The Ultimate Trip, and the forthcoming feature film Shasta. He is also the producer of the popular documentary films 2012, The Odyssey, and its sequel, Time Wave 2013. I would like to welcome to the show, to Fade to Black, Jay Weidner. Jay, are you with us?
I am.
How are you tonight? Everything good?
Everything is good. All systems go.
All right. You know, we were talking earlier. You know how excited I am, so I'm going to try to hide that for now. But this is just a free-form conversation. We're sitting in my living room. We have about 80 different compass points we can go to as far as directions, and we'll just see where things end up at the end of the night. You ready?
Yeah, that's what we do.
Now, this is the thing, and I want you to introduce yourself to everybody a little bit. I think most of the audience out there knows who you are. But one of the cool things about you, for me personally, is you save a lot of time for me because everything that I'm interested in, and it's crazy because it just goes, it's such a broad stroke of the pen with you. I can find all of that stuff at, you know, a single point of reference called Jay Weidner. And I just find that fascinating. And to the point where, and we were talking earlier, and we'll talk about the Fulcanelli book here in a second, but you apparently found that probably very close to my house. And I find that ironic, too, as well. I really do.
Well, we were probably living pretty close to each other because I was living in the same area, you know, so... I was writing screenplays in Hollywood and almost all during the 80s. And one of my favorite things was to wander around and buy books at book sales. North Hollywood seemed to have a lot of good book sales, too, I remember.
And there was also, if you remember, right there in North Hollywood on Magnolia and Laurel Canyon,
yep,
was that bookstore.
Yep.
You know which one I'm talking about.
I do. I can't remember the name of it.
I can't remember. I used to know the owners. They were two brothers. One of them drove an antique car.
Yeah, I actually lived in Laurel Canyon on Wonderland and would come down the hill and go to that bookstore all the time.
Actually, I had a friend that lived on Wonderland and Laurel Canyon, right by the Studio City Grill.
Yep. This is where Jim Morrison lived, and he lived on Wonderland. In fact, he lived about three doors down the street from where I lived, and Ray Manzarek still lived there when I was there. He's, of course, long gone now.
And for everybody out there that doesn't know the area that we're talking about, it's a very, very creative part of the valley. And to tell you the truth, if you go into a restaurant on a Sunday morning, anywhere on Ventura Boulevard, right there, it's a who's who. You know, you never know who's going to be sitting. You walk in, and like you're saying, it could be Ray Manzarek or some actor.
Actually,
or director.
The most interesting people in L.A. live in Laurel Canyon and North Hollywood, I think.
Absolutely. And it's a very, very, very creative area.
It really is. I can almost tell when I'm talking to someone that they're from that area. There's just something about them. I'll say I met a director, actually the director of the remake of The Shining, at a film festival last year, and we were talking, and I said, I said, I'll bet you live in Laurel Canyon. He says, how'd you know that? Like, because you lick it, man. You got long hair. You smell like pot.
And that country store that's right there.
Yeah, that's the store that Jim Morrison sang about.
Yes, 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 yeah. Yes. It's I used to have, I somehow knew this conversation was going to result. I used to have a studio literally right around the corner there at Mount Olympus and by the Coconut Teaser. You remember the famous Coconut Teaser. I had a studio there for years, and I recorded every band on the Sunset Strip. But it was such a community of musicians and writers and directors, and everybody lived there. And everybody was in everybody's business. You knew it was like the smallest community.
It was.
Yeah, and people think L.A. is this big, huge place, but so much goes on
just
right
in that
there.
Little area.
Yep.
A little band that goes from Studio City across the canyon over to Hollywood, and it's like incredible. And you can, I used to take my motorcycle up over the Wonderland to Mount Lookout, and then go down the other side into L.A.
Right.
Amazing difference, leaving this, like, winding roads and big trees and then coming down into Los Angeles. You know?
Well, and what I used to do, instead of freeways, I would put up with the traffic of Laurel Canyon because that drive is just so beautiful.
It still is. In fact, I just did it recently. Like within a month ago, I took the entire Laurel Canyon Drive to go see my old house, which is still there, by the way.
You know what? It hasn't changed.
No, it looks exactly. There's more people now and more traffic than there used to be. But no, it hasn't changed at all.
No, the houses that were there in 1975 are the houses that are there right now.
They haven't been gentrified or anything.
Right,
I was stunned, actually, to see it. I thought I was going to go there and see all those old houses torn down and brand new McMansions up everywhere and nothing.
Not a one.
No.
Did you ever go to Houdini's house?
I ate dinner there.
Isn't that the coolest place?
That is the most amazing place. I mean, sometime I would love to do a documentary on weird Los Angeles.
Well, that would be like a nine-parter.
900-hour film. I mean, I could go on and on about weird Los Angeles. You know, I have, in fact, all the way from Manson to Roman Polanski and Jack Nicholson and Marlon Brando sharing the same property together. And, I mean, it is... There are some hair-raising stories about Los Angeles.
Every time you can finish a story, you can just dovetail it right into another one. And
you can, and they're all connected. It's like they talk about 6 degrees. It's more like 2 degrees.
Well, you know, there's one thing that, we're talking about actors and that side of the industry, but then you have that whole music side of the industry too as well that ran this town for years.
Yeah, and it was all buried in Laurel Canyon together, the actors, the movie directors, and the musicians.
Absolutely. And it went through just like the movie industry, the music industry went through 2-3 phases. And I was stuck in that Sunset Strip 1980s phenomena that went down.
Yeah, that's when I was there.
Yeah, and people ask
going to the Whiskey a Go-Go.
Yep. Gazzari's. And people ask me all the time because they know about my history of being on the Strip and producing bands. And, well, I played too as well. But what was it like, and the only response that I have is it was a moment in time. You can never predict when something's going to start and stop like that and just take over the world. But it wasn't as big as people think. In that was only, it's only like three blocks right there on Sunset Boulevard where you have the Whiskey. Started at Tower Records, really. But
it did. In fact, bands used to play in front of Tower Records.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And go up to Gazzari's, the Roxy, the Whiskey, and then of course down Doheny you had the Troubadour.
Yep.
So that was it. It was just a little small spot. But on any given night, from 1980, 1979 to 1985, 86, 87, You had everything from...
Dude, that's exactly when I lived there. I lived there from 1978 till 1989.
You had Van Halen, Guns N' Roses, Motley Crue, Great White, Warrant, Poison, all those big bands. That we were just all friends hanging out on the Strip.
Yep.
And it was a very small community, and we didn't know that the world was changing in front of us and stuff. We didn't know. We were just having fun. And now looking back, oh, man, what a great time it was.
Well, it was like actually it was the last breath of the great golden age of rock and roll. We didn't know it.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. And then it was weird because in 1984, 85, you would drive up and down the Strip through that spot, and there would be 10,000 people on the streets.
Easy.
Yep. And then suddenly, like 1988, 89.
Went away.
It was a ghost town.
In fact, all of L.A. or Hollywood and suddenly changed. And I would say a lot of people probably think for the better, but it lost a lot of its soul. You know, they cleaned up the streets. They got all the hookers off. And up until about 89, it was pretty loaded with hookers.
Yes.
And, you know, condoms in the streets. And, you know, it had a kind of a texture that it doesn't have anymore that I just, you know, I don't know. I miss it.
No, you're exactly right. And it will never, that was just a lucky thing where the stars and the moon aligned.
Yeah.
It was probably somewhere on the Hendaye Cross. You know, it was there. But
well, that's funny because that's where, you know, not only did I get my start with Fulcanelli and the Hendaye Cross, but it's really where I made most of my discoveries was in L.A. from 86 to 89. I made most of them then.
Well, you know what? That's a good, you know, let's segue because I could sit here and talk about the Sunset Strip all night long, and apparently so could you. So, and we'll save that for another time.
Yeah.
But this is what I would like everybody to do really quick. Everybody knows the drill. Go over to jimmychurchradio.com on the homepage and scroll down, and you will see the Jay Weidner's. It says Stanley Kubrick. My producers did that, and I didn't get a chance to change it. But it's a gallery about the Hendaye Cross, and it says Stanley Kubrick. And for everybody out there, we've got these eight pictures here. We're going to start this conversation off tonight with these eight photographs because, and I want everybody to understand, what starts Jay's life of research and wonderment starts here, and everything just kind of fans out, and it touches on so many different subjects. We can even get into archons and the Nag Hammadi if we wanted to, just off of these eight photographs. Let's start here with the Hendaye Cross, and everybody's going to start looking at these now. But let's start with Fulcanelli. Let's start with the chance of finding this book. How did you find the book, and when did you first read it? And let's just start there.
Like I was saying before, I was living in Laurel Canyon in north, you know, on the North Hollywood side, and I would go down on weekends. I was a screenwriter, and I would go down on weekends usually to book sales because I'm a book collector. And one day I found a book sale. The old guy had died. His wife was selling his books, and then she obviously did not know what she was doing. And I found 20 or so books, as I remember, were 20 books for $20. And I gave a $20 bill to her and walked away with 20 books. And I didn't really look at them for a few days, but then one day I started picking them up and looking at them, and very impressed, and still own all 20 books. Very impressed with the collection. Really, at that moment, wished that I'd brought, you know, $60 or $80 to the dang thing. And but you know, the garage sale was over, and I couldn't remember where it was anymore. And so I was stuck with these 20 books, and I began reading them. And one of the first books I read was a book called Mystery of the Cathedrals by a man with a single name, Fulcanelli. And I was kind of a fan of architecture, especially medieval architecture. So I thought, it was going to be a book about architecture, you know, how they built the cathedrals, the mystery of how they built them, because there actually is a mystery as to how they built them. Quite advanced architectural and construction methods for, you know, 13th and 14th century, kind of jaw-dropping in a lot of ways. So I picked up the book and started reading it, and kind of got angry, actually, at first while I was reading it, because first off, I was having a devil of a time understanding what I was reading. I thought I was a smart guy, and this guy was, like, really talking over my head. And secondly, he wasn't talking about architecture of cathedrals at all. He was trying to tell me that alchemy, the science of alchemy, was really true, and that the cathedrals had were built, the ancient Gothic cathedrals of France and Europe, of which there are over 500 of them, were built by alchemists, and that the secret of alchemy was inscribed on the walls of many of these cathedrals, but in particular in Notre Dame in Paris. So, you know, I'm frustrated. I tugged my way through the book because I'm a Taurus, and we don't like to give up. And I got all the way to the end, and I just threw the book down and slammed against the wall and went, I have a friggin' idea what this book is about. You know, and it lay there on the ground for about a week, and then I kept looking at it every morning when I got up. And then finally one day I went over and I picked it up, and I said, there's no book that I can't understand. So I'm going to read this again. So I started reading it again. Only this time, I noticed that every few words there were italicized. And I couldn't understand why he did that. So I began going to the library and looking up each of the italicized words and then finding out as much as I could about them. Well, this took place from about 1986 until about 1989, as I was saying before. And by the 1989, I'd read the book maybe 8 or 9 times. And by now I was actually changed, beginning to be changed as a person, and beginning to entertain ideas that before I would never have entertained, you know, and began to think that everything I had been taught was actually wrong. And that kind of pissed me off. And the more I looked, especially at the italicized words within the book, Mystery of the Cathedrals, the more I realized that the history I had been taught, the math I had been taught, the science I had been taught, everything that I had been taught was bunk. And even worse, I began to realize that people a long time ago actually may have understood things even better than we understand them now. And that just blew my mind, and I didn't know what to say. My marriage began crumbling. I began losing all my friends. My family quit talking to me because everyone thought I was really getting strange. And I kept, you know.
Well, going. You were. You were.
I was. I am. And eventually, you know, I decided to go to Hendaye, because Hendaye is a town in the southwest corner of France, right on the border with Spain, because the last chapter of the book, Mystery of the Cathedrals, or the second to the last chapter, actually, is about this cross that sits in a churchyard in Hendaye, France. And Fulcanelli, the writer, is kind of oblique about this cross and really doesn't tell you much, except that it's telling you that, you know, there's going to be this incredibly catastrophic change coming soon, and that if you can figure out the decipher this cross, you can figure out just about when and what is going to happen.
Okay, well, I'm gonna cut you off there. Let's not go there yet, because that's the good stuff. let's back up for a second. Alchemy, did you even understand what you were reading? Did you have an interest in that?
No, not at all. In fact, after my first reading, I set out to debunk the book, and the book debunked me. And eventually, and so, you know, I was an atheist and a materialist scientist, I was a journalist, and I believed, you know, that, you know, everything could be figured out by science. And by the time the book got done with me, you know, I not only believed in alchemy, I believed that materialist science, what we worship today, is actually going in the wrong direction, and is it perilous, causing perilous dangers for the human race.
What's fascinating with me is Fulcanelli, and I want to talk, we need to spend a few minutes on him, actually, because he was either real, or he wasn't, or maybe somebody was ghostwriting and made him up. That all of these are possibilities.
Yep.
But what is real about Fulcanelli is the book was published. That there is no doubt. And how many? They only printed in the original in Paris, 300 copies, right?
Yeah, 300. And they became worth a fortune within months after they were published.
And it freaked Europe out.
It did. In fact, the OSS, the precursor to the CIA, actually searched Paris for Fulcanelli, looking for him, because they believed that he had secrets that they didn't think could be possible, you know, nuclear secrets and things like that,
and
which he did.
Yes, and see, that's one of the more fascinating aspects about him, and we can actually get into that right away. What I want everybody to understand that's listening right now, Fulcanelli, and it's Fulcanelli, which is actually, and that's what the Italians used to do. You would have something on the front of your name and something at the end, and it would make some sense. And Canelli, I have actually some paintings of some different guys that were, you know, they painted canals, so their name was, you know what I mean?
His name means, if you take his name apart, it means Vulcan, which is volcano, and Canelli, which is canal or tunnel. And so it's tunnel in the volcano.
Yeah.
What's interesting about that is Nassim Harriman, the alternative physicist, he has a whole theory, and I've discussed this with him, that lava tubes and tunnels, which are tunnels in volcanoes, have a compressed what they are, of course, is where the lava went through, and then the lava froze and compressed and shrunk and created a tube. And there's immense minerals built into the walls of these round lava tubes, and I've been in several lava tubes, I know what he's talking about, and they created this incredibly intense electromagnetic field that moves around in a circle, in a spiral. And Nassim Harriman says that you could actually use a lava tube as kind of a stargate to move around inside wormholes, because it creates this tremendous electromagnetic vortex. And I really wonder if that isn't what Fulcanelli is trying to tell us with his name.
Yeah, exactly. And that there are no coincidences, you know.
Yeah.
So, or maybe there are, but
very few.
But exactly.
Yeah.
Now, so Fulcanelli, and this is what, for everybody out there, it's one of the most fascinating guys that you can go and research out there, because this is not urban legend, okay? So the guy, whether he was being impersonated or was an impersonator or whatever, was a real guy. And this is the thing for me, Jay, is he had students, you know, and that's a bizarre thing. That's a bizarre twist too, because the students knew who the real Fulcanelli was, either he was real or not or whatever, but they were being taught by him.
Yep.
And he, so let's back up a little bit. What was he teaching? And also, I'd like you to comment on some people actually witnessed him. We'll get into the Philosopher's Stone too. Actually, transform lead into gold. So let's back up to that era in Paris, because I want everybody to understand who Fulcanelli is. So that way, the book, and then we'll get into the Cross of Hendaye.
Yeah. So it was, you know, World War One had ended, and Europe was completely destroyed, and all of the smart people, the artists and scientists and philosophers in Europe and the United States went to Paris. Ernest Hemingway, James Joyce from Ireland, Gertrude Stein, everybody came to Paris because it felt like there had been this catastrophe. And there was nothing left, and nowhere else to go. people don't realize how really horrendous World War One was, and because it's been kind of eclipsed by World War Two, which actually was a much more humane war in some ways than World War One. And out of this milieu of people coming to Paris, you know, in the early 20s, emerged a man, you know, who was teaching and talking about the ancient knowledge of alchemy. And it just seemed so out of place in, you know, the dawn of the modern world. And he had a lot of people that gathered around him, but in particular, Julian Champagne and Eugene Cancellet and a few others. And he would teach them, supposedly, he would teach them all the secrets of alchemy. Now, if alchemy is about extending your life, then he must not have been very successful in his teachings, because Champagne died a few years later, and Cancellet died in the late 50s or early 60s. So I don't really think that what Fulcanelli was doing was teaching alchemy so much as creating a framework for leaving behind his book, Mysteries of the Cathedrals, which would then kind of act like a time bomb, in that it would be out in the public and people would find it and read it, and then they would become initiated into this mystery, like I was. And that was the entire point. So then the question becomes, well, who would want to do this? And what's the point of this? And my answer is that, and Fulcanelli is quite clear when he talks about this in his book, there's a group of people, there was a break in the mystic Freemasonic tradition around 1750, I believe, sometime in that time period, was a break between the French Freemasons and the British Freemasons, or between one kind of Freemasonry and another kind of Freemasonry. I can't tell you what the break was about. I just know there was a break. And you could say the bad guys took over Freemasonry. We'll call it the dark Freemasons. And they took over Freemasonry. And the light Freemasonry people, they ran for their lives away from these people. And I believe that Fulcanelli or his group that he came from is from this group of the light Freemasons. And they went underground. And this other group, whom we now call the Illuminati, is searching for them and trying to find them, because they believe that they have great secrets. And they do probably have great secrets. So what I believe Fulcanelli was is he came out of this group and went to Paris at the end of World War One, because they were so afraid of what they had seen in World War One, and he began creating this framework to release a bunch of the secrets and to initiate people in a very strange way that would wake them up, like me. And I'm not alone. There's many, many people that have been woken up by Fulcanelli.
Right.
So
Do you think that if it was Champagne, and I want you to answer that question very directly here in a second, but if it was Champagne, Champagne couldn't and wouldn't reveal everything under his own, you know, because that would throw. And so, did he have to do it under a pseudonym? Is that where we're at with this?
No, actually, I don't think it was Champagne. I think Champagne, though, was instructed to create clues that would make it look like him, and to create certain appearances in public that would make it look like him, to make sure that the track was completely thrown off. I think it was really, really important to throw the track off, because I think the secret society knew what was at stake. The fact that the OSS was sent in to find Fulcanelli, you know, is proof that they were after him, and they were after him for some reason. What that reason is, I don't know. I do know that the secret of alchemy is in the book, Mystery of the Cathedrals, mm-hmm. And if they, you know, if they know it, then they should have that secret. If they don't know it, then maybe there's something about them, the bad guys, that makes them not be able to figure this stuff out, is what I mean, I don't know exactly. I feel as if, you know, the whole very first Harry Potter book was actually a Fulcanelli story. It was taken from a Eugene Cancellet story, his student. And what happened is, is that Eugene Cancellet did not see Fulcanelli again after 1932. He was a very young man. He was about 24 years old at the time. And he went back to Paris to live after Fulcanelli left, or went to the East, whatever that means. And then one day in 1953, he received a letter in the mail with a seal, just like Harry Potter does in the first Harry Potter movie.
Right.
And there's a beautifully written, aristocratically crafted letter telling Eugene Cancellet to go to the train station in Seville, Spain. Harry Potter receives a letter, is told to go to a train station, if you remember.
Right.
Okay, so Eugene Cancellet goes to a train station in Seville, and he's picked up by two strangers. He's blindfolded, and he's taken into the Pyrenees, a long drive into the Pyrenees Mountains. At least he thinks it's the Pyrenees. And he's driven around, obviously trying to confuse him. And then eventually they come up to a castle, just like Harry Potter goes to a big castle in the mountains. And everybody dresses in medieval attire, just like everybody in Harry Potter dresses in medieval attire. And it's a school for alchemists. And there's children that come to the school. And this is all written by Eugene Cancellet in the 50s. And he goes there, and there's alchemy labs and everything. And he meets Fulcanelli. And it's 30 years now since he's seen Fulcanelli. And Fulcanelli, who was 80 when he saw him in 1932, is now about 50, which would go right with the alchemical secret in that you unwind every year 1 year. So if you found the alchemical secret when you were 60 and you took it for 20 years until you were 80, you would now look like you're 40.
Now, Cancellet, yeah. And did he know who the real Fulcanelli was?
Yes.
And why did he keep that secret so guarded?
Because Fulcanelli told him to. Because he said, he must have told Cancellet the whole thing, that there's this secret school that's hiding from the bad guys, and we're trying to change the world, but we have to do it very subtly. And then maybe Cancellet, lost faith in that whole thing, and then Fulcanelli brought him to the castle for two reasons. One, to show him it was true, and two, to give him the chapter, the Hendaye chapter.
Right.
Which is why the printing of Mystery of the Cathedrals in 1958, remember he went to the castle in 1953,
right,
now contained a new mysterious chapter on the cyclic cross of Hendaye. So I believe that the whole point of bringing him to the castle was that World War II now, this is 1953, World War II had now just occurred, nuclear weapons had gone off, and I believe that this insider group that lived in the castle was very terrified about what they were seeing and decided to release the final secret of the apocalypse through the Hendaye chapter.
Well, and this is where there's so many mysteries in this story coming up to this point. We haven't even got into the meat of the matter, but Lubitz, he knew who the real Fulcanelli was too.
Yes, he did. Yeah, they had many conversations.
And yep. He also claimed plagiarism, that yep. He had written Cathedrals or had given Fulcanelli a manuscript, I think, or
no,
notes.
No, again, that's a cover story created by Fulcanelli. He asked Schwaller to make him discredit me as much as you can. I don't want anyone to follow me or figure it out, right?
Yeah, back to my point.
Yep.
It's nothing but mystery on mystery with this, and it is. And the thing is, the story is true. The story is real.
It is.
It is as nutty and fun and crazy and disturbing, all rolled into one. Now, okay, so now let's get to, now that we've laid all of that mess out there, what exactly did Mystery of the Cathedrals, before we get to the last chapter, what is it that was on all of these cathedral walls? Notre Dame.
Yeah, it was how to make the, it was both the spiritual transformation of humanity was depicted, but also the alchemical, the way that you can create the way that you can create the elixir of life is put there in the little inscriptions that are on the wall. And you have to figure it out. Unfortunately, there's been a lot of vandalism, I think some of it done for on purpose, so that, you know, some of the panels that are on Notre Dame, for instance, somebody's, you know, taken a hammer to them and knocked them all out so you can't see them. But, you know, a lot of it is still there. So, you know, the entire secret of alchemy is really about the pineal gland. And the pineal gland, there's a study done in Princeton University in the 80s, and you can read about this in a great book called The Melatonin Miracle. And this is all true, verified scientific research, where they took pineal glands out of young rats and put them in the brains of old rats, and the old rats began reversing aging and going backwards and becoming young. They took the old gland, old pineal glands from the old rats, and they put them in the brains of the young rats, and the young rats aged very rapidly and died. Okay, so the whole key to aging and everything is this little pine cone-shaped gland that's in the center of your brain. And it's the last thing that actually forms in the human body, which is why a baby's head is still soft at the top. Because the very last part of the brain and the body that forms is this part, because of it's so important. The pineal gland is attached to like an overarching body of energy that surrounds the entire planet. We're connected by what is called the Shashumna in Hindu lore. It's a little tiny vortex. It connects the pineal gland to the larger electromagnetic fields that surround the Earth. The aurora borealis being the visible part of that. Mm-hmm. So the pineal gland has to stay. So somehow we can't go and replace our pineal glands with younger pineal glands. That's not going to work. So then the question becomes in alchemy, okay, so then what do you do since you can't do that? And then the answer is, well, what causes the pineal gland to get old? And the answer to that is it calcifies. Slowly the salts that you drink in your water and in your food slowly gather up like plaque on your both all your glands, your entire endocrine system. And so then the question in alchemy becomes, okay, so then how do you decalcify your pineal gland? And the answers to that are surprisingly simple. And if you look at the depictions of alchemy, you can see that they're teaching you how to create a liquid which causes your pineal gland to decalcify quickly.
And now, although alchemy, and I think a lot of people think of it first of, you know, gold and changing things, but the Philosopher's Stone, and let's get into that now, but the elixir of life was probably more important to an alchemist, that goal, than anything else.
Yeah, because I think that's what they really mean. I mean, lead, when you're getting old, you know, your muscles begin atrophying. It's much harder to walk upstairs. You know, it's just hard. You're turning into lead. You're getting heavier. Even though, you know, you're not really gaining weight, you're still gaining weight. And it's weird. And you're densifying. And then when you decalcify the pineal gland, you get lighter. I mean, your blood starts flowing better, and your blood-brain barrier gets better, and your muscle tissue comes back, and it's like becoming gold again. And you glow, frankly. You
right,
glow.
Right, right, right.
And the light gold. And so, you know, you have stories like Count Saint Germain, who lived to be 230, 240 years old, and that kind of thing. And I believe it's true. I believe I had a friend who was working on Jimmy Carter's Habitat for Humanity campaign in India, building houses, and he met a Sufi master that had married. He was living with a couple that was from India, who were in their late 50s, and he had married that guy's great grandfather, and he was still alive. I mean, they said, "Yeah, he married my great grandfather," and so these things are not really all that mysterious. It's really quite practical science, actually. All you have to do is decalcify the pineal gland. I'm letting a lot out here, by the way. Is decalcify the pineal gland, and you will reverse your aging process. This secret could destroy you know, the powers that be. Because if it's an easy thing to get out, and it is, then pretty soon, if we all had the ability to suddenly get young, we wouldn't need the healthcare system. We wouldn't. A lot of things would change very quickly.
When the book came out in 1926, now there's 300 copies. Now everybody, well, that's interested, but has wondered about the secrets of alchemy, and it's such a dark place where, you know, how do I say this? Well, anyway, but now the books hit the streets. Were they running around from cathedral to cathedral trying to decipher and get? Because now finally the secrets are in print. If you can understand what he's written, then you could go and locate the different cathedrals and actually get to these secrets of alchemy. Is that what was going on in 1926?
You got it. Bingo. You scored 4.0. That's exactly right. That's the whole point. Was to go and use the book to show that all over the place were these secrets, and that all you had to do was look and you could figure it out for yourself. And then that way he doesn't have to be overt about it. And also it creates you doing this, me doing it, for instance, which I really did.
Right.
It's an exercise that is incredibly enlightening. So by forcing me to go to all the cathedrals that I could go to in Europe and France, I didn't just learn about the inscriptions of alchemy on the walls. I learned about the history of Europe. I learned about all the great people that had been in all these cathedrals, and Napoleon being coronated in Notre Dame. And, you know, you come back with a firm sense of history and reality that you don't get from history books.
What did you... I mean, you went, you've got the book in hand, right?
Mm-hmm.
Did you just start from chapter one? And now, were the cathedrals just concentrated in Paris, or did they actually spread out, and like with Hendaye in the south of France?
They're everywhere.
How many cathedrals total, and did you visit each one?
Well, there's over 500 in Europe, so no, I did not build each one.
But there wasn't 500 in the book.
No, there's about 12 in the book.
That's what I mean.
I visited everyone that's in the book. Yeah.
Okay, and what did you find?
Amazing things. I found a recurring motif, which really helped me understand the Hendaye research, which is the four signs of the zodiac, the fixed signs, which are in every cathedral, everywhere from Chartres to every one of them has it, which is, you know, all part of the deciphering of the time periods. So they all have this emphasis on Taurus, Leo, Scorpio, and Aquarius, right? As if it's like the, like, you know, 1 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 6 o'clock, or 12 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 6 o'clock, and 9 o'clock on the dial. And that something happens when we pass into one of these areas. So then, you know, and so that, and I thought, why would the church, which outlawed astrology,
right,
have all of these astrological symbols all pointing to this thing? And then that sent me into looking, okay, so if we're about to go into the age of Aquarius, did something happen, you know, 6,000 years ago at the beginning of the age of Taurus? Would that be historically of note? And of course, yeah, that's right. When cities start being built, when writing is discovered, when agriculture starts, when wars and walled cities, and you can see right at the beginning of the age of Taurus, there's this wild and crazy change in history. So I said, okay, let's go back another second. Let's go back to Leo. Is there anything that happened in Leo that was amazing and shocking to history? And again, we find the great extinctions of the giant tree
frogs
and the woolly mammoths,
right,
and the melting of the glaciers and the ending of the ice age. And,
mm-hmm,
and it's just like, whoa, you know, two hits in a row here, right? And then you can go back one full cycle, say 26,000 years ago from now to the last time that we were entering the age of Aquarius, and boom, if you look at when they say Neanderthals died out and Cro-Magnon finally took over, bingo, it's give or take 5,000 years, so 26,000 years ago, they say. So, you know, you keep going back through these cycles, And you can see that there is definitely some odd business going on. Fortunately, my friend, astrophysicist Paul LaViolette, did ice core drillings in his book, which I made a documentary of, Earth Under Fire, and he found the same thing, that every, 12,000 years, 18,000 years, 24,000 years, any multiple of this 6,000-year deal, there's this kind of cosmic ray bombardment, gamma rays coming in, solar fluctuations, and I just, there's a lot of scientific evidence to back this thing up. So I'm not saying it's mystical. I'm saying that it's cyclical.
Your head must have been swimming.
It still is, to be honest with you. I visited the George Washington Masonic Museum several years ago in Virginia.
Right.
And all these books that were under glass. And I started looking at all these books and their insignias and their symbols. And, I hate to say this, but I walked away from that saying to myself, I already have the knowledge of the Hendaye Cross, of course, but that the entire, I'll say this open, I don't know if I've ever said this either, the entire point of Freemasonry appears to me to be nothing more than the passing down from generation to generation the knowledge that there is a gigantic solar outburst every 6,000 to 12,000 years.
And there's a reason why those the sun symbols that you see all over,
yep,
have that wincing face.
That's right.
I'm serious.
I'm
not kidding.
The angry sun.
Yeah, the angry sun, and or angry, or maybe even freaked out, I think is also a way to look at it. That's the way when I see it, I see sometimes confusion, I see sadness, I see anger, but what I don't see is happy.
No. And what's amazing about all this is that when my book, the first book, came out about the Cross of Hendaye in 1999, I went and did my regular radio circuit, tried to get as much publicity for the book as I could. And I said, he's warning about this solar catastrophe. He says it's going to happen, some kind of, class X5 solar flare thing. And I got in a debate at the University of Colorado with a guy from NASA who literally said that this was insane, the sun was a stable star,
right,
this was crazy, rash speculation by someone who's not a real scientist, made me feel really bad, causing fear and panic. And then, weirdly enough, by 2003, 4 years later, NASA's completely whistling a different tune,
yep,
running around like chickens with their heads cut off, screaming that we've got to do something because...
that's the thing, and you've hit it right on the head. We were all raised, not only you and I, but I'm talking about all of humanity for the last 2,000 years, that the sun is the most stable thing we know. Now it is the most unstable thing
it
we
really
know.
It is.
Yeah, and I, and you're absolutely right.
Yeah, and I'm gratified. And if it took, I was told by a CIA guy that both of my books have been highly valued in the intelligence agencies. So I'm grateful that maybe I caused them to wake up. What I think happened is that break in Freemasonry, which occurred, 250 so years ago. I think that this secret got lost. They had all these symbols, and they had everything, but they didn't know how to interpret them. The good guys, the people who actually understood all this stuff, had ran and hid. And I believe that Fulcanelli released the chapter on Hendaye in 1953 to Eugene Cancelle because they knew that the timeline was rapidly approaching, and he wanted us to save ourselves somehow, some way.
Now, one of the... let's get back to Fulcanelli really quick. So one of the crazy little twists in the story is we had Champagne's death in 1932. Lubitz, Schwaller said that Fulcanelli died in 1932, that he,
yep,
was really sick. So then you have that connection there.
Yep.
But Fulcanelli was telling people in 1938 that we were getting ready to blow ourselves up with this nuclear knowledge, and we needed to chill out.
Yep.
So we had this contradicting, you know, I want to believe Schwaller, I do, and we know where Champagne's grave is, okay, and he definitely died in 1932.
Oh, no, he was definitely a drug addict.
And, you know, it's such a fascinating part of this story. And then for Fulcanelli to come out, and there was no doubt that the Allies were interested in where this guy was because he had this nuclear knowledge as well.
Well, yeah, exactly. He knew too much.
He knew way too much. And the quotes that you see, in fact, share a couple of those. He had said... The first one about nuclear fission. I think
he said that there are men right now who are attempting to split the atom. This is a secret that we've held for thousands of years, and we've held it because the release of this knowledge will threaten every single living thing on Earth. And the guy he told it to worked in the patent office, Jacques Bergier.
Right.
And he had no idea what the hell this guy was talking about.
No, when he said just a small amounts of metal.
Yeah, will destroy all life. And so then he went and he told a bunch of people, and then eventually French intelligence heard this, went to the OSS and said, listen, this guy, somebody's walking around who's obviously knows way more than we should. We got to scoop this guy up because he knows what we're working on. How does he know what we're working on? Because the Manhattan Project is one of the most tightly kept secrets.
Exactly.
Hadn't even started, actually, at the time. But they were working on it, even before the Manhattan Project. There are many people working on it, including Einstein and Oppenheimer. And so, you know, this just bolsters what you just said, just bolsters my entire concept that Fulcanelli came down from the castle, from this group of extremely enlightened people, and came down to try to salvage the human race.
Is he still alive?
Yeah,
he is, isn't he?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
There's a whole bunch of people still alive. Have been here for a long time. I believe that they walk among us.
Now, okay. So let's go really quick because I want to get into Hendaye really quick. Well, because we're going to spend a lot of time on Hendaye. So everybody go to the gallery right now in the front of JimmyChurchRadio.com, and there's three pictures of Fulcanelli, or the alleged Champagne Fulcanelli slash. But let's go to the bottom right, and let's open up that picture first. And the bottom right in the bottom row, and it's a painting, and it's a self-portrait. And who and what is this?
I'm trying to find it.
The lower right hand. The last picture in the bottom row.
I can't find the pictures. Is it under...
scroll to the bottom of JimmyChurchRadio.com.
Yep.
And you'll see your...
Oh, there they are.
Yeah, gotcha. Yeah. Okay.
Oh, that's a Eugene Cancellé's self-portrait.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So we look at this. So that's Cancellé.
Yeah.
And then we go to...
No, that's Champagne.
I'm sorry, Champagne.
Champagne self-portrait, yeah.
That's Champagne self-portrait.
Yeah.
And then, so I need everybody to open that up and kind of take a good, strong look at that. And then go to the pencil drawing in the top row on the right. And that drawing was done in 1930 of who?
Hang on. Oh, I'm getting lost again. A little hard time navigating this. Hang on.
Well, it's a pencil sketch of Fulcanelli.
Right.
That was done in 1930.
Oh, yeah, right, yeah.
And
that's the one that Schwaller had.
That's the one that Schwaller had. So that pencil sketch and the self-portrait of Champagne, and I know you don't think Champagne is Fulcanelli.
No.
But that's a little bit too close to home, and I don't.
I know right where you're going. I've had these discussions for many, many hours. Yes. This is all part of the cover up scheme to make sure that they can never that the road is ice cold behind Fulcanelli.
Now, what about the photograph, though, of Champagne in his little studio, which is the black and white picture? Okay, so is this are these all the same guy? It looks like the same guy to me.
Yeah, it's the same guy.
So explain the cover up. It's so good. This story is just amazing. I just love it.
Yeah, it's you know there is a group of people, you know, the Illuminati, who really has it in for these guys. Okay, and they really want them, and they want them bad. And they have to hide from them. And so, and these guys are actually on our side, the good guys, the Fulcanelli guys. They're on our side, and they're trying to wake us up. I call them the roosters and the owls. So Fulcanelli's group I call the roosters. They're trying to wake us up. The other guys are the owls, and they're trying to keep us asleep. And it's interesting because they apparently worship Moloch the owl out at their little groove out in California every year. And he came and he taught and he left behind his book, and he made sure that there was a cover up of so that no one would ever find him, because he knew that they would come looking for him, and they did. And but he did enough things, like the scene with Jacques Vergier, where, you know, in 1938, that were enough to convince someone who was following the trail that no, it could not have been Champagne. No, it could not have been any of these guys. It has to be somebody completely different. And Champagne was merely set up as the guy, as the foil. And Schwaller is playing along. The reason I believe this is because I know one of my best friends actually knew the Dulevich family and hung out with Lucy LeMay, who is Schwaller's daughter. And she said that what happened was that Schwaller Dulevich was living, I think, in Switzerland, and he was running a school called, like, the School of Light. It was a metaphysical school of some kind.
Right.
Up in the mountains. And this is in the mid-20s. This is like 1932, something like that. I can't remember exactly the year. Maybe it was the late 20s. Either way, this is a private story. I don't think it's ever been published. One night they got a visit from a very distinguished-looking man who claimed he was a Sufi, and he wanted to talk to Schwaller. And so Schwaller and this man went into another room and talked for the entire night. No one knows what they talked about. And the man then got up in the morning and left and said goodbye to everybody and left. And then Schwaller turned around and said, okay, well, we're discontinuing the school. And he said to his wife, pack up everything. We're moving to Egypt. We're moving to Luxor. And they did. And he went to Luxor and spent the next 20 years measuring and studying the Temple of Luxor, which is not, then wrote a book, an amazing book, The Temple of Man, which was translated by Robert Lawler, who's my friend who knew the Dulevichs and who told me this story. And it's an incredibly huge and voluminous and very difficult, incredible book. But again, we see this mysterious guiding hand at work, if you see what I mean. A mysterious stranger comes in, completely changes Schwaller's life, more or less tells him to go to Egypt to study the symbols and everything and to write this book, and he does.
And he does.
And yeah, and again, I believe that was Fulcanelli. And I believe that Fulcanelli... I believe that the group that he comes from in this castle are actually Sufis, which is not really Islamic. They're just a mystical group that practices alchemy, spiritual alchemy. And they know the secret of alchemy.
Tell me the truth, Jay. Are you working on the screenplay right now?
I can't believe I haven't been approached by Hollywood, to be honest with you.
I can't. You know, and if you do, just write me in there somewhere. I'll be the pizza guy or something.
I will. I'll get you in there.
Okay, now let's get to... Oh, that is crazy. Okay, so that's why I did not know.
Very few people know that story. In fact, if it's more than five, I'd be surprised. Well, I guess there's a lot more now.
Yeah, there's a lot more now. okay, so now this is where things get crazy. So now He's the secrets of alchemy are out. The mystery of the cathedrals is out.
Yep.
People are looking. And
well,
then
remember the Cross of Hendaye chapter is not in.
Well, hold on. That's what I was just getting. I'm setting it up.
Okay.
So everybody's out. Everybody's looking. And then all of a sudden in the 50s, the last chapter of the book comes out, and the reprint happens in the book, which is the Cross of Hendaye. Now, yeah. I would like everybody to go to jimmychurchradio.com and let's go to the first picture in the gallery, top row. Let's open that up, and there it is. Now, I'll let you continue, but I'll just finish with this. This cross is 350 years old in 1950. So I guess now is it 400 years old today?
Yep.
Okay. So. Yep. This cross is 400 years old. There's inscriptions all over it. I'm going to let you take it from there. Describe the cross. What are we looking at? And where is it?
That is my photograph, too, by the way. I took that in 1995, I think. So we're in this churchyard, and we're looking straight on to the cross as you would see it if you were walking, you know, by the church. This is how you would see it. You'd see the front part of the cross. There's a cross on the very top of the pillar, and then there's a pedestal at the bottom, which has that angry sun with four stars around it. And you can see that the sun is small. There's a small sun, and then you can see there's another ring around the sun, like the sun is expanding or getting bigger or something, right?
Right.
Then you go up the pole and you see the cross. At the very top of the cross is an X, and then there's the words "O Cruce Pessinica," and that right there is what you would see as you go by. If you spoke Latin, which most people did when this cross was built 400 years ago, you would think that inscription said, "Hail the cross, our only hope." All right? So that's the front. We'll get to what all that means in a second. But
okay, one question really quick as you continue, but I'm just going to jump in. When you first did it have a religious to it when you first saw it? I don't want to say the wrong thing here, but it doesn't vibe me as a religious looking thing. Do you understand what I'm trying to say?
Yeah, I do, and it's not. And it is what I believe is that it is the exact replica of a monument that was beginning to fall apart, and that they actually recarved that monument and made a duplicate of it in 400 years ago, and that it sat there, you know, for 400 or 500 years before that, and then that was a duplicate of one that had sat there for 400 or 500 years before that, et cetera, et cetera. So I believe that this is something that's being duplicated through the centuries.
Now, the base itself, I don't want to segue too much here, but does it look like the cross has been sitting in this same spot?
No, it was actually in the cemetery,
right?
And got moved there in the mid 1800s.
I gotcha.
A local rich family. I've been inside this local rich family's castle that's now a museum, and these guys were all alchemists too. Yeah.
Okay, so let's get back. Okay, so now we just went from top to bottom. Go ahead.
All right, so then let's take a trip around the cross. So let's go to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Let's go to the sixth picture. It'll be a third down on the right.
Okay, picture number 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Got it? Third?
Okay. These are the four symbols on the pedestal of the cross.
Yep.
As you go around the cross. So the sun faces what you see on the west side, and then you go to the south side and you see that eight-pointed star.
Right.
Then you go to the I'm gonna get this straight now. No, I got that wrong. You go to the south side. You get the four A's that are in the odd oval. You go to the north, the east side, and you get the eight-pointed star, and you go to the north side, and you get the fairy tale moon.
So the moon is on the backside of the sun.
No, the star is on the exact opposite of the sun.
The sun, okay.
And the moon, it's very important that you understand that, because there's a relationship between all these.
Exactly.
Yeah. So if you could look through the sun, if that pedestal was a glass cube and you could look through it,
right,
you would see that eight-pointed star surrounding that angry sun face.
Got you.
You would also see the moon perfectly in the groove of the oval shape of the A's.
Got you.
All right?
Right, right. So looking at the sun to the front, is the moon on the left side?
Yes.
Okay, and then the A's are on the right side.
Yes.
Stars are in the back.
Yep, the stars in the back.
Okay, so let's we talked about the sun and what, you know, its angry face, and it does look pretty, it looks upset, looks constipated, if you ask me. And I'm not saying that in a, because that's exactly what's going on. So the what do the four stars mean around the sun?
Okay, so they're saying basically that when the sun, let me do this a little different so I can get back to that.
Okay.
So every time you cycle around this pedestal, you learn more and more stuff, all right? So let's take our first round, okay? So we go to the eight-pointed star, and we realize that that is an explosion of some kind, and the rays are moving outwards. Okay. Then we go to the next one, and we see that the oval is broken up into four quadrants with the strange broken A, which looks just like the Freemasonic symbol of the compass and square.
Right.
Then you go to the moon, and you notice that the moon has an eye, like
it
a fairy
sure
tale
does.
Moon has an eye, and it looks like a boat on its side. If you turn the thing around, you look, and you can see that it looks like a boat. In fact, it looks like an Egyptian boat, actually.
Yes, it does.
And that hole is called a hawse hole. It's where the anchor chain for the boat comes out. All right? And it looks like there's three people or two or three people also in the boat. All right?
I got
you. That's one way around. Okay? So then Fulcanelli tells us that these things are describing a double catastrophe. And that if you look at it, you can figure out what that double catastrophe is and when it's going to happen. So, you know, naturally intrigued by all of this, I began looking, and I began realizing that the four A's were for the four ages. The Leo, Scorpio, Taurus, Aquarius angle on the zodiac. So if you took that oval and said that is the precession of the equinox, the time it takes for the Earth to go through one full tilt session, 26,000 years,
right,
and you look at that cross, and every single point where that cross is the fixed point in the compass for one of the four fixed signs, then you can say, okay, so the oval is indicating that when we get to one of the four fixed signs, this possibility of this double catastrophe could happen, right?
Interesting.
Right. Okay, and below that is the moon. Okay, so what does the moon and the oval have in common? Well, the moon is our greatest local chronological timekeeper.
Yep.
It's how we keep time. The precession of the equinoxes represented by the four A's is our longest period of how to keep time. All right, 26,000 years
through
the four 12 signs of the zodiac.
Right.
So we have our shortest way to keep time and our longest way to keep time by the stars and the planets.
Got you.
Right. So the left side of this thing is a calendar. The right side is a description of what happens. Okay. So the double catastrophe is the top star, the eight-pointed star. That's the first part of the double catastrophe, and the exploding sun is the second part of the double catastrophe. So the first part of the double catastrophe causes the second part of the double catastrophe to happen. They're a chain. And what I think that it is Dr. LaViolette's theory of a synchronotic explosion from the center of the galaxy, which apparently happens on a regular basis according to his ice core drillings.
Right.
This sends a flurry of dust across the very center rim of the galaxy, eventually gets to us. It envelops the sun in a cloud of dust, which causes the sun to act like a pot on the stove with boiling water, but the lid is on, because the dust causes it to be encased and cannot let the heat out. So the sun gets hotter and hotter, and then eventually begins to go through periodic explosions, of which affect the four inner planets, Earth, Mars, Venus, and Mercury, represented by the four stars that surround the sun.
I'm with
Follow
you.
Me?
Yep.
Okay, so let's go back to your picture.
Okay, yeah. And, well, hold on. Before we on the star, okay, yeah. Above the sun, on the eight-pointed star,
yeah.
Is there an object at 3 o'clock inside the...
No, that's actually, John, just the entire edifice falling apart.
Okay, so that's just an artifact.
Yeah.
Okay, there isn't anything of significance there. Okay, no. Before we jump back out of this, let's get to the pictures. But why are those letter A's?
Are they letter A's? Yes,
yes they
they're
are letter
A's. But they're also mountains. The A's are mountains, and the little indentation, which looks like the compass and square from Freemasonry,
yep.
The broken crossbar,
yes.
That's the tunnels that are in the mountains.
I got
That's where you go to get away from the exploding sun.
I got you. Okay. Okay, so now, which picture do you want to go to next?
So let's go to... the inscription, which is picture number 4, where the inscription above the angry sun.
Okay.
Where it says, O Cruxes Pessinica.
Okay, that's picture number 3.
Yep.
Okay.
All right, so Fulcanelli tells us that this tells you where there is a place of safety. If you can figure out how to decipher this phrase. Okay, now the weird thing about this is that the person who built this misspelled the words. It should be O Cruxave with at the end of the E, and then the S at the end of the top word should actually be at the bottom word, so it should read Spes Unica, the only hope, okay, which is what that means. So the sculpturer of the Cross of Hendaye really screwed up, right? It would be like saying United States, but having it be United and an S, Uniteds, and then Tate at the bottom, right?
Right, right.
Really a silly mistake. But it isn't a mistake. It was done on purpose, and it was done to call attention to itself.
Okay, before you say, and I read about this, you've written about this before.
Yeah.
But could it be also correct? Or is there no way that
no way.
This is correct? I mean, there's no way.
No way.
No way. Okay.
No way.
All right.
Furthermore, the cross has been very carefully planned and sketched, obviously, with a ruler, and, you know, was not done ad hoc or quickly. So even that really makes a spelling mistake even more of a stunner.
Yeah, exactly. And, well, I'm sure nobody lost his job. It was done on purpose.
Exactly.
Okay, got you.
All right, so I wanted to figure out at this point, and I thank you for letting me do this, because I don't usually get to, everybody always likes to talk about Stanley Kubrick, and I never get to talk about the Cross of Hendaye. So I decided one day to sit down and figure out why he was saying that this was going to tell us where the place of refuge to get away from this double catastrophe was. For one thing, it was for my own survival, so I wanted to figure it out. So as I wrote the words down just as they are on the cross there on a piece of paper, and I just carried it around with me. And any time that I was bored or whatever, I would just lay the paper down and look at it.
Right.
And, you know, high IQ is pattern recognition, essentially. If you do an IQ test, it's essentially a test on pattern recognition. And I just happen to be very good at pattern recognition. So I was sitting there, and I realized that the very center of that phrase on the cross was an X or a cross. And that struck me as odd, you know. And furthermore, if you look at it, there's four words with four letters on all four sides of that cross.
That's right.
So now that really got me going. And because it fit within the motif of the cross. The cross has four sides.
Eight. Blah, yeah, blah, blah. Yeah, it's
exactly.
Yes.
So it was falling into, and it would also explain the spelling error. why you would do it. So what I did was I then divided up the thing into four separate words, and this is all in my book, if you want to see it, how I did it. And I re-scrambled the words, and it came out to say Inca Cave, Cusco, Peru. And it came out perfect. I mean, there was no wasted letters or anything. And then I thought to myself, well, hey, it's coming out in English? But then I looked it up, and I realized that, no, the Cusco is spelled with an S, the Spanish style of how you spell Cusco. And the caves is actually a word that passes through Italian, French, English, German, intact.
Right.
So I had a phrase that could be read in like seven different languages perfectly.
And you didn't really have to scramble. You didn't have to.
No,
most of the words are already there.
Yeah, it wasn't a big deep scramble.
Right. Right.
Yeah. So then, you know, I'm like, whoa, you know, this is really wild. And I began looking up, you know, anything that had to do with Cusco. And then I remembered, of course, that for absolutely no reason at all, in the middle of Mystery of the Cathedrals, Fulcanelli goes off on this tangent about how the high priests of the Peruvian Incans knew all the secrets. And you just, it's like a throwaway three-sentence thing, and we're off onto another subject, right? And I'm like, what? It always bothered me.
Right.
So, you know, I went to Cusco, and I did everything that I was supposed to do, and I found these caves. They're actually everywhere, and they're deep, and people get lost in them, and there are warnings everywhere. Don't go in these caves. They keep going on for David Hatcher Childress told me that he was in a cave that was at least 50 miles long.
Well,
and it was built by humans.
And I want to remind everybody of his name, Fulcanelli.
Exactly.
And it all comes around. Okay, so continue. But it's just, it is a, the thing is, I want everybody to just sink this into your frontal lobes. This is a true story. This is real. This is not imaginary. Okay, continue. So now you're in Peru.
Yeah, and I'm going, you know, I'm looking around and everything, and I'm starting to read the histories of Peru, and I'm starting to figure out that actually Pizarro had a court alchemist in the group with him that was given to him by King Francis, I think, of Spain, and that this alchemist knew all this stuff. Then I found the drawings of Pizarro's artists that went with him, and one of the art pieces that he had was The Secret of the Incas, and it was an oval with four signs. One was an angry sun, one was a moon, one was an eight-pointed star,
no.
And one was a cave, the caves at Toliapango. So, which of course I then went to those caves,
right?
And there's these deep caves, and they obviously were created by humans. They have straight walls, and the Incas say, when you ask the Inca, the Quechua, who built this, they say they were built here long before we got here, dude. They don't even claim that they did it. They don't, you know, and what's interesting about all this is that this was 97 when I went there at the height of my research, and then when I went back to Peru to do a film in 2007, every single one of those cave entrances had been sealed off, and there was military in front of them.
No.
Yep.
And they wouldn't let
me anywhere near it.
Exactly.
They saw my camera, and they would point their gun at me and say, you get out of here.
I've heard you tell this story before, so why, I know the answer, but I know everybody else now is just wondering what's going on. Why would they, it's not only in Peru, but it seems to be a worldwide phenomena where you used to be able to just go into caves, you know, why do you think, like I said, I know the answer, so I'm just going to let you answer it. Why are they sealing off caves, Jay?
Because they don't want us to save ourselves.
the energy that could potentially be there. Well, you know what?
You're exactly right. There is a hyperdimensional aspect, especially of volcano tubes, like I said, and literally they don't want you to find any of this out. Alchemy is not just one thing. It's a multifaceted art form. I don't call it a science. I call it an art form. And they don't want us to find out any of it. It's like, this is like the number one directive of the Illuminati, is to make sure that we don't find out any of this knowledge, because I believe that their grasp on power is much less firm than we think it is, and that we are like one tiny bit of knowledge away from overthrowing them, and they know it.
Now, the underground, the alchemy underground, they know who you are.
Yep.
Do you have a hotline? And I'm not joking around. I mean, have you spoken to each other? Would you tell me if you did?
Yeah, I have. I'm actually contacted quite frequently by many people within that world, and I have a fairly good reputation with them. They think I'm a blabbermouth. They wish I would shut up, but they don't understand what I'm trying to do. Although I think that's actually starting to change, whereas 10 years ago they thought that I was being profane and releasing secrets and talking about stuff. I think now they realize the danger of the present situation and how important it is to get this out now.
Right.
So I can feel that whole, the landscape is beginning to change, desperateness of the times seems to say that if we are not given these secrets soon, we as a race and this planet may not even be able to survive. So it's now at that point that they have to do it or we die. And I think that they want it out, and I think it is going to come out.
Well, I'm not patting myself on the back, but isn't it advantageous for them to have it be discussed openly rather than not?
Well, the reason I discuss it openly, and I do believe I'm probably one of the few people that even talk about alchemy in public, is to prevent us from getting burned at the stake again,
exactly
like happened last time. So I'm kind of stealing a chapter from the gays and from the marijuana guys. I figure that just go and let it all hang out and screw them.
Well, and what I expect, and this is why I asked you earlier, I'm kind of asking questions for the listeners about, do you think Fulcanelli is still alive? Because I believe that he is.
Yeah, he is.
Would it surprise you if he just popped up on YouTube one day or on television with a message? I mean,
no, he wouldn't do that.
Why not? No.
Because they don't
want... He did it with the book in the only way that he could communicate to the masses in 1926.
But you still had to read the book.
Right.
You still had to do the work. You cannot be given the answers to the test for free. You just can't. That's not the way it works. So each person listening has to learn the answers for themselves. I'm not giving you the answers. I'm just telling you what I found in my life and in my experiences. But the only thing that's tangible is what you go through. And, you pick and choose your battles. I particularly am a person, I want to know everything that's going on. And so I pursue as much of a variety of knowledge as I possibly can so that I can figure out exactly what is going on. And, it's a self-evolving process. But I think that we all have to do it. There's no more... A great man who is anonymous once told me, there are no more masters. There's no more masters that you can go to and learn great secrets. He said, the way that things work now is through synchronicity. So when you have a coincidence or synchronicity in your life, that's a bell going off. And you need to wake up and figure out what you're being told, because these forces are speaking to us. They are telling us everything. We're just not listening. A lot of us just don't even know how to listen. But all I can say is, you know, when you have a weird experience, something that happens, you know, you are being, that is a significant thing, and you should not let it go by without thinking about what just happened to you.
With when you went ahead and deciphered everything, you were down in Peru. What significant did you find a connection in Peru back to the Cross of Hendaye?
Yeah, I found that book, which was written by Pizarro's artist, which had all of the same symbols of the Cross of Hendaye, and this was the major secret of the Incas. And I also found that the Incas also believed that the sun got angry. In fact, their hero, Viracocha, in the legend 12,000 years ago, which is right when Fulcanelli says this all happened, he ran into a cave. He took the people and they went into the caves and they waited out the great fire. And Viracocha would stick a stick out the cave opening and would catch fire. And finally, one day it didn't catch fire, and he said, okay, it's safe to come out. And then they created the great civilization that followed it. This is their legend.
Did you go back to, I mean, I can't imagine, you know, the meltdown that you were having as far as your brain activity goes.
Yeah.
Did you take all of this and go back to Paris and start to figure out a little more? I have a couple of the big questions here next, but
yeah, that's exactly what I did. I kept bouncing back and forth from Peru to the United States and then over to Paris and into the south of France, and, you know, forays into Egypt and several other places. But I kept looking and finding and basically seeing the same pattern over and over. Something that had to do with the sun, something that had to do with the four fixed signs, something that had to do with a secret group that lives here on the planet with us and it has a love-hate relationship with the human race.
And,
they're humanoids.
This is where we're exactly where we need to go to next, but I want to tie in where you're going back to Hendaye. And obviously we're getting into some religious aspects now too as well.
Yeah.
And so how did you tie before you get into, you know, we can say the word now, okay, we can do that. But how did you tie in all of this with, you know, the Gnostic Gospels? Something, you turned a page somewhere, not figuratively, not literally, but somehow you tied all of this together. How did that happen?
Well, I guess what I was doing was I was getting it pretty well, and I was realizing that this thing called alchemy had to have, you know, been seriously old and created by some civilization that had such an incredible understanding of nature that was so far beyond our materialist science that I kept trying to imagine how they did it, how they discovered all this stuff, and then reading my Fulcanelli over and over again, I realized that he was intimating that there was a group of beings that lived here on this planet with us at the same time, and that alchemy was their science. It's sort of like the story of Prometheus. Prometheus is, he steals the fire from the gods, and he teaches humans how to make fire.
Right.
And when he is captured by the gods, and then he's tied to a rock where crows eat his guts for eternity. That's how a horrible thing that he did, right? And so what if fire is actually alchemy, not fire? And because you need fire to do your alchemy, though. So fire is an essential thing to have to know in order for you to be able to perform alchemical experiments. So, it is considered a huge crime by some group that we call the gods to give the secrets to us lowly humans. And so that got me thinking about about the gods. And I started reading the Ramayana, the Purana texts from India, the Greek myths of Zeus and Hercules, and anything that had to do with gods, and Akhenaten, and all of these guys. And I started realizing that, you know, they were essentially talking about a group of people that were not humans, that were coming down from ships, demanding sacrifices of not only people, but animals and baskets of food. And apparently they lived in caves, and they take their ships, their Vimayana craft or whatever culture you're reading about, and these ships go up in the end of the mountains, and they go up into caves and disappear. And so I said to myself one day, I'm going to start taking this literally. I've been taught my whole life that this is all mythology, not true, just stories. But what if we take this literally? What if we go to the Ramayana or the Greek myths, and we say that there really are some kind of other humans that are here with us, who are manipulating us, having sex with us, taking our food, stealing cows, basically controlling us. And this took me all the way back into the dawn of civilization, which happened in Mesopotamia about 6,000 years ago. And I realized that civilization itself seemed to spring out of nothing. There didn't seem to be any precursors to it. It was as if suddenly we knew agriculture, suddenly we had writing, suddenly we had math, suddenly we understood sacred geometry, and it's just weird. And then I realized that, no, this has to be the intrusion of a much longer ancient civilization that began to intrude itself into human history about 6,000 years ago.
Were you able to cross-reference each religion, not only, you know, with the Bible and Jewish and Hebrew, and also over to the Indian and Greek? Was there a commonality?
Yes, a shocking commonality, in fact. Very human gods in every case, gods that lust, gods that are jealous, gods that are warlike, gods that murder without problem, manipulate, greedy, you know, not really what you would call, but beautiful, stunningly beautiful, always attractive, you know, everyone would be looking at them if they walked into a room. And this is both be in the Ramayana or in the Mahabharata texts from India, or wherever you look, you get the same thing, the kind of the Archangel Michael kind of thing, you know, this big stunning looking person, you know, with, you know, blonde hair and tall and big blue eyes and high cheekbones, and always the same description. Either extremely white, pale skin, or slightly bluish. And I believe that the slightly bluish is the capillary system being seen through the older creatures when their skin begins to thin and get more diaphanous. So I believe, you know, through the Fulcanelli stuff, that, and I believe that they live in these tunnels in the mountains, you know, on Earth.
I got a quick email that came in. I've been instructed to read this anonymously, so I will. It says, I have heard from trusted sources that the owl symbol often found ties back to Horus and Osiris, that the Illuminati worship him one and the same. Any further findings on this?
Yeah, I mean, I can't prove any of that, but, you know, just ancillary evidence would say that's correct, that they worship this Moloch the owl, that it basically comes down from Egypt through various transmutations, and I believe that they worship the owl because the owl keeps us all asleep, and, you know, this, to keep us asleep. Well, the owl comes out at night while we're sleeping. They only do their stuff at night. They're doing everything behind the scenes, and they're against the roosters who are trying to wake us up, Fulcanelli being the top rooster. Stanley Kubrick, of course, being a rooster.
Right.
So, you know, I believe that the alchemy came from this group. They've lived here with us. They've been manipulating us for a very long time. They're the ones who drove us into the cities back 6,000 years ago at the turn of this age. They put us on the grain diet. They enslaved us. They made us do work for them. And we've been paying the price ever since.
Now, did you find a direct tie also with Christianity and maybe, you know, the resurrection? Was that able to tie in also?
Well,
all the other standout items in the Bible that I would find, you know, almost correlating to as well. But let's start there.
Well, let's just talk about the whole story of Jesus, okay? Because it's really the story of alchemy. Jesus is the Son, and his mother is Mary, which is water. Mary means water. And he's conceived by a interaction between a being, an angel or a god, and Mary, and he's conceived. So he is now of the same half lineage as the gods. All right, just like all the other ones, like Hercules and all the other demigods, right, that existed before.
Sure.
So he's a demigod by virtue of his birth. Okay. Then he goes through what you might call the calcination and the distillation upon the great cross during his trials. And he's placed up on the cross where he dies. Then he's taken down from the cross, and the cross is like the crucible where your alchemy is done. And he's put into a cave, you know, in a mountain, and in the darkness. And then 3 days later, he resumes his life. He is resurrected. And that is the story of alchemy. Alchemy is a mixture of fire and water. It's formed in a crucible or a cross. And you have to go into a dark cave for a few days after you go through the crucible, where you go through an agonizing experience, and you will have a rebirth, and you will come out reborn. And so I believe that it's a thinly disguised description on one level of alchemy. On another level, though, on the overt level, and I'm not going to get into the religious connotations as much as the political connotations, it's fairly clear from the story of Jesus that he's extremely pissed off at the Pharisees and believes that they're evil, and he believes that the church, the bank is their church, and he overthrows the bankers, and a few weeks later, after he throws the bankers out of the church,
right,
out of the synagogue, you know, they come and get him and kill him. And I believe what you're reading there is a rebellion against the archons and the archonic, who are these creatures, by the way, a battle against the uprising against the overt nature of the archons taking over the spiritual practices of his people. And he paid the price dearly for it.
Well, I swear, we think you and I just were right on, we are on a wavelength. I was just going to bring up archons. So let's start with a definition. What is an archon?
Well, archons are, actually it's a Greek word which means rulers, directly translated. Interestingly enough, the word anarchist is a Greek word which means against the archons. And we all know what anarchist connotations are. My first bump with the archons was reading the Nag Hammadi text, a chapter which you can actually get on the internet called The Hypostasis of the Archons. The Nag Hammadi were, of course, texts written and found in Egypt. They were written 2,000 years ago, and they were found in Egypt in clay jars in 1945, That I also don't believe is an accident, because the most important thing about the Nag Hammadi is that we can actually see what people thought 2,000 years ago. We don't have to worry about, you know, presidents and popes and kings rewriting history.
Right.
We can actually see what they say.
Right.
And they warn about these archons, and they say that they're off-planet, interplanetary is actually more appropriate, interplanetary beings who have come here and who are creating a false culture, a false reality that we think is real. And the whole purpose of it is to for us to be the Archons' slaves, and for the Archons to kind of tap our spiritual energy, and they kind of live off of it like vampires. In fact, I believe the vampire myth actually is about the Archons. And that they have no feelings. They're completely unempathetic. And I'm drawing the illusion, you know, lately, that our modern day Archons would be described by medical science as psychopaths. Psychopaths have are different from other human beings. They have a different brain structure, and they do not have the ability to be empathetic to people. They don't feel feelings. They don't. Everything that psychopaths
they don't care.
Do,
they, right, right.
Yeah, they imitate you. If you laugh, they laugh.
Right.
If you cry, they look sad. But they don't really have any real feelings themselves. This is a description by psychiatrists, not me. Particularly Robert Hare from Vancouver, who has constructed the psychopath test. So I contend to you that if there's a person walking around that looks like a human being, but they don't have the ability to, you know, be empathic towards other human beings. They don't have really the ability to love or to cherish human life or human beings. Then I actually say, well, then they're not humans, because the thing that makes us human is that.
Right.
That's what makes us human. So therefore, they're not humans. So therefore, I think actually we're starting to zero in on the entire Archon problem. I'm being joined by several other people now who've kind of reached the same conclusions, including John Lash and several other researchers who are now seeing that psychopaths are the Archons. And when you start understanding what the Archons are and how they act, you cannot watch politicians anymore.
Right.
You just see them everywhere. I mean, and they are the rulers. That is what they are. They're the rulers. They use psychopathic means to achieve power, and that's all they want. And that's what the Archons want.
And it all starts to, when you take that in its totality, then everything starts to fall into place. War, politicians, no feelings.
The fact that they never do what we want.
Exactly, and they don't care.
They don't care. They don't care what we want.
And it's been going on forever. Now let's move forward again. Now, see, you and I are starting to tie all of this together for the audience, and it's kind of frightening when you start to look at it. And all of this started from you finding that book in North Hollywood. You know,
never underestimate a small moment.
Yeah, you just can't. You can't.
No.
Now, okay, so now let's move forward. And these are some broad questions. But do you think Fulcanelli was in a way talking about the Archons, was warning us? Alchemists know about the Archons. What is the relationship there? That's like five questions in a row, but you can start with the first one.
Yeah, they're very worried about the Archons because of the whole, like the whole Prometheus myth, and they know all about it. And then you know, and let's face it, you know, the Catholic Church fried the alchemists during the Inquisition, and so interestingly enough, Karen Hoods, the World Bank expert who now has turned gone renegade, become a conspiracy theorist, came out last week and said, I couldn't believe this, I think she said the tall white aliens are running the Vatican. and that they've been running them for like 1,000 years now. To which I just about dropped my jaw when I heard it. So I thought, wow, that's really interesting.
Wow.
Because I actually believe that, that these archons have been running the Vatican and the Roman Empire before that. In fact, the Roman Empire never died. It just switched guises. You know, around 800 A.D., they just switched and became the Catholic Church. It was very, very neatly done. And the archons are, most people just want to live their life. They want to, you know, they want to have a kid. They want to eat good food. They want to, you know, do what they do to have fun. But there's another group of people that live here with us, and all they seek is power. And they spend all their time seeking power, manipulating, conspiring, stealing, killing. And they're only 3% of the population, but they're causing 99% of all the problems. And the Nag Hammadi identifies them. The Book of Enoch identifies them. It's a book that was left out of the Bible.
Right.
That is actually more important than most of the books in the Bible.
Right.
I believe the story of Jesus was a rebellion against the archons, a failed rebellion. And I believe that the archon problem is the single most difficult problem that we face on Earth, because they don't give a damn about Fukushima. They don't give a damn about depleted uranium. I mean, it is impossible for a person who's not a psychopath to understand how a psychopath thinks. So we have to kind of say, okay, we have to fight these people in a different kind of way, in a different kind of battle, not face-to-face, because that won't work. They'll beat us. We have to identify them, identify their behavior, and they're in a campaign right now because people are beginning to make this connection between archons and psychopaths very clearly now, that they are actually trying to propagandize that psychopathic behavior is cool and okay.
I'm going to ask this question in a second. This email just came in. Check this out. Hi. Owls are often seen in ET experiences, and they stand for hidden knowledge. The resurrection is the rebirth of man after a planetary destruction. The ETs repopulate the Earth after each planetary destruction, and the cross of Hendaye is the complete 26,000-year cycle leading to a new change in consciousness.
There you go. That's exactly right. We're right in the middle of that change right now. It started about 10 years ago, and it's going to go for, you know, 20, 30 more years. We're only at the very beginning of it.
Now that we've kind of told the whole story, and I know that right now, see, most people, you know, listen to this type of show late at night, in the dark, in their room, and now that we've freaked out about half of the country, but they've learned something tonight, and if they haven't, if they didn't know about this, well, they certainly know about it now, and tomorrow the research starts. We're going to continue with a couple of things, but I wanted to let everybody know, you can go to jimmychurchradio.com, just click on Jay's name, that'll take you over to his website, Sacred Mysteries. All of his videos are there, books, everything is there, and also jayweidner.com too as well. Kind of a mirror site. Are the two sites kind of... because I go to both.
Well, one is jayweidner.com is where I just put out my research for free. And then the other place is where my more advanced studies and films and everything are. And and I have a new film coming out, a feature film with actors and everything called Shasta, which is about everything we're talking about.
Yeah, and we're going to – all of that is later. I want to talk about Shasta. I went to – it was probably about 6 months ago. I went to look up Shasta, and we're going to talk about that in a second. I couldn't find anything. So, you know what? I'll talk to you about that in a second. Well, I went to IMDb, and it wasn't there.
No.
And
it just got finished.
Okay, so.
ShastaTheMovie.com.
Okay. Oh, we'll get to that. Now. So, with this 26,000-year cycle, with the sun giving us this warning, amongst other things, on the cross of Hendaye, have you calculated any, and don't scare me too much, but have you calculated a date? Have you, you know,
No, I call it the season of the apocalypse, you know, and I've looked into, you know, NASA has, again, ever since my two books came out, not saying that I'm the cause of it, but NASA has really stepped up their solar research since my books came out, and, you know, they're getting a little worried about what they're finding on the sun, frankly, and they're even to the point now where they're wondering if carbon dating is completely wrong, because their idea that there's a constant stream of the same wave of radiation coming from the sun, which is the whole basis for carbon dating, they now know is wrong. They know that the sun is wildly fluctuated in its gamma and rays in the last few years, and, you know, we just started measuring it, so, you know, it's probably been wildly varying forever.
Right.
And we know that the electromagnetic field of the sun is beginning to diminish and is flipping, or I think it has flipped, and we are kind of doing a mirror thing with our own electromagnetic field on Earth. And then we're also seeing the sunspot activity disappearing, which is also unheard of. So I believe that the sun is the kind of the purveyor of consciousness on Earth, and the change in the sun, and I can tell you the sun's light is much different now than it was 40 years ago.
Oh, you mean the color of the sun in the sky?
Yes, it's now, it used to be yellow.
I remember.
Now it's white.
Right.
I mean, if you looked at children's drawings or photographs, I've been photographing the sun since I was about 10 years old, and I cannot take the photographs of the sun that I used to be able to take.
No, and I thought I was, I thought it was only me that was noticing that, because it's been a little bit gradual too. But I remember, orange.
Yep.
Orange is the word that I want. You said yellow, but
yellow orange. Yeah.
Yeah. That was the sun. It was like an orange in the sky. It was an orange thing, and you could almost look at it. Now,
it's
white.
Just this big, bright, white thing, and it's just so bright you can barely stand it. And you talk to people, and, you know, the temperature will be 80 degrees, but, you know, it feels hotter. That's because the UV from the sun is going up, and we don't know why that is going on either. And so what I think is going on is that the center of the equatorial region of the sun rotates at a different rate than the poles. So the poles rotate every 26 days, and equator, I think it's every 78 days or 80 days, something like that. And so what's going on is that the magnetic fields are crossing over. No, it's 26. They cross over every 82 days. Is what
I'm
saying.
Right.
And I think that what happens is over a 26,000-year-long period, eventually this electromagnetic field begins to bind up, like three magnets really, one on each side of the poles and one in the center, kind of causing a really confused electromagnetic field, which then has to right itself. And so then it kind of just pops back into sync again. And that could also be what's going on.
Well, the warning is there. You know, it's right there.
Yep.
Is there anything that we can do, or is this just an inevitable changing of the times, changing of the guard, and we're just going to start over once again?
Pine cones in the deep forest can't grow until there's a forest fire. So the new pine trees cannot grow until after the place has been scrubbed clean by a fire. That's just the facts of life. I don't want to really scare people, but
right. That's
the facts of life. And there's an alchemical saying, you know, in fire, nature is renewed whole. So, you know, there are good aspects of this. It does cleanse the earth. Of course, the problem with it happening now is there's about 800 nuclear power plants all over the planet, which will begin overheating, and then will go nuclear, and then all life on Earth will be over. So this may be exactly what Fulcanelli and the Cross of Hendaye are really warning us about, the foolish idea of making these nuclear power plants, which if the solar flare came, because let's not forget, if even a minor solar flare came like the event in 1859, which wiped out all the telegraph wires, we would lose every single cooling generator for every single nuclear power plant on Earth.
Right.
And this isn't even a big explosion off the sun. This is just a medium-sized one if it just hits the right direction.
Right.
So I think we really need to start rethinking nuclear power. And if we are going to do nuclear power, then maybe every single nuclear power plant on Earth should have a generator which keeps it going for at least 5 years with enough fuel until we can get the world back together again after one of these events.
Do we go and live in those caves? Isn't that the crazy part? What do you do? Okay, now, Jay, will you do me a favor?
Yeah.
Let's change subjects.
Okay.
Let's talk about Stanley Kubrick.
Say what?
Right turn. But
not really.
Exactly. Thank you. Stanley blows my mind. Let's just start there. And not only is he has managed to. It's very difficult in the life of a director. There's only one Spielberg. You know what I mean? There's only one Scorsese. There are tens of thousands of directors here in Los Angeles. Forget about the globe. Every waiter that you order food from has got something in development.
Yep.
And it's the way that it is. Now, to get up to the level of Kubrick, that's it. You're counting on one hand that level of genius and talent. But he managed to make probably the best science fiction film of all time, number one. He did that. Probably one of the funniest films of all time. He pulled that off, too. Cinematography, special effects, not only in 2001, but across the board. You can look at his war movies, and you can look at the way he shot the Revolutionary War and the Barry Lyndon he was able to, everything that he touched, he was the best at. And so that's Kubrick to me. Now when I tell you that I'm a Kubrick fan, I am. I own all of his movies. My wife and I watch them. I can't tell you how many times a year we watch 2001. I'm being serious about that.
I believe it.
And we don't. It's not only the science fiction aspect and the story, but also you just sometimes I'll watch the movie and I'll look at the background. I won't even listen to the dialogue. I'll look at other stuff and discover things in the movie all the time.
Yep.
The same thing with The Shining too, as well. I won't be looking at Nicholson. I'll be looking in the background. I want to see what's sitting on a table. And why it's there, why it's on a shelf. And that is Kubrick to me. So when I ask you to talk about Stanley Kubrick, it's coming from, for me, a true affection. Okay? So yeah. Let's start there. What does Kubrick mean to you? Before we get deep, what does he mean to you?
Well, he's a renegade artist, a genius, a person who did what they wanted to do and not what society wanted him to do. He cut his own path through the wilderness. He was really the first commercial filmmaker, who understood the technical aspects of filmmaking, from editing to lighting to everything, film stocks and lenses and what they did and how they did it. He was a perfectionist and had a high IQ and very curious guy. So he started out trying to make films, but then on his third film, The Killing, which is a great film, he began to really start working with different kinds of technique. And in The Killing, of course, he's working with time. He's cutting back and forth between different times, showing you the same event from different perspectives. And, you know, way before films like Memento, and, you know, really screwing with your head, really.
Right.
It's a mind screw, the whole movie is. And there's so many details that go by so fast that, you know, if, when you think about how little money he spent for in that movie, you really realize that, you know, what a real work of genius that was.
Well, and you have to think about also when that movie was shot. He had nothing to base it on. He was creating. I don't want to say genius, but he was showing everybody exactly what can be done when there was no example of it before that.
That's right, and on a low budget. And you know, he's just a kid, and he's putting films out like that. You know, it's caused Orson Welles to walk away from The Killing and said, "I don't know who that kid is, but he's going to be a one hell of a filmmaker."
Right, right. And for me, also, as I'm just trying to lay a little foundation here to Kubrick, but for him to go from everything before Dr. Strangelove, but then to make Dr. Strangelove, because at that point there was nothing that even came remotely close to the technical aspects of Strangelove, but also it was a comedy, but it was made, he was so perfect down to the lettering on every single switch on the inside of the B-52, you know what I mean? Everything was technically perfect, but then to go from that, because that was an achievement, but then to go to 2001 and have this giant leap of technology that was right there on the screen, and it was only, let me think about this now, 4 years later.
Yep.
And so now we have the statement of 2001. I want to back up for a second. I saw this mockumentary called The Dark Side of the Moon. Have you seen it?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Now, I'm going to ask you directly then, since you have seen it. I know you know how my mind works by now. Was that CIA propaganda BS?
Yeah. Everything in the movie, but... the interview with Christiana Kubrick.
In the beginning, but okay.
Yeah, everything else was like a film school, how to manipulate a film by editing to make it say something that it wasn't being said.
Okay, so it's not just me that's thinking like that. Okay.
No, it was ridiculous.
Okay, but no, hey, it was a great movie.
Yeah.
Oh, I thoroughly enjoyed it and laughed. But the only way to get those people in the movie, and I'm talking about Kessinger and Schultz and
Rumsfeld,
to participate in a movie like that is that there's some government influence coming from somewhere. There's no way those guys are going on film making that sort of movie unless somebody told them to do it. And I could be wrong.
Oh, no, that's what happened. What happened is that Christiana Kubrick gave an interview to this French film crew that were doing a TV story on Stanley. And she let him into the estate, and she did the interview. And you can watch the interview in the film, and she gave a lot more away than she should have.
She started to get diarrhea of the mouth.
She did.
And wasn't it's the his cinematographer is sitting there with her, too, as well.
Yes.
And he's the one that reveals... The lenses
from NASA. Right. NASA gave Stanley, hey, we got a couple $1 million lenses each year. You want them, Stanley? Here, have them for free. So I think that got out, and people started talking about how the odd things that she was saying, and by then my essay had been, already had like 20 million hits on you know, the alchemical nature of 2001.
Right.
And people were, you know, becoming interested in all the strangeness around Stanley. So I think they kind of looked at this interview, and I think the CIA saw the interview and said, ah, we got to squash this.
We got to fix it.
Yeah, we got to make a whole ridiculous movie around it that'll make this interview look ridiculous.
Now, I love the movie. I don't want anybody to misunderstand what I am saying.
Yeah, I mean, it is worth watching because it's worth an intelligence
watching.
Feast.
It is an intelligence feast.
And, yeah, you can see how they manipulate it.
And the movie is called The Dark Side of the Moon. You can find it on YouTube.
Yep.
Don't confuse it with Pink Floyd, okay? It's called The Dark Side of the Moon. And if you search Dark Side of the Moon / Kubrick, it'll take you straight there. Watch it from beginning to end. After you listen to what Jay and I now have to say, what this movie means with Kubrick and the moon landings. Oh, by the way, you know who I had on the show last week?
Huh.
Bart Seibel.
Really?
Yep.
Oh, I'd like to talk to him.
Yeah, got him to come out of retirement, and he spent a full 3 hours with us. And this is what happened with me, and this all has to relate to you, too, as well. When you start to go down that Kubrick moon landing hoax road, and it's a rabbit hole, once you get sucked into that, things start to surface, and you are one of them. So I'm putting all these pieces to the puzzle together, and then I see the dark side of the moon, and I'm like, aha, there's something to this. There's no way that this kind of propaganda is getting out there. And the revelations that Weidner has put together, Bart Seibel has stumbled upon his stuff. And yeah. You know what? It all fits, Jay.
It does. It's all one big symphony.
Yes, it all fits.
Yep.
So do you think, now these are the direct questions, and then we'll back up and talk about Kubrick and 2001 and The Shining. Okay, so we'll put all this together. Do you think Kubrick shot that stuff? And do you think we went to the moon? Do you think that Kubrick just filled in the blanks for NASA and the government? Or do you think that it was all just one big hoax?
Oh, I think it was more inclusive. I would say we went to the moon, but we didn't go the way that we think that we were told that we did. We have much higher technology, which we got from the Germans. Just read any of the books by Joseph Farrell, and you'll see that we had much higher technology. We wouldn't have used an old jalopy like a Saturn V to get to the moon. Besides, getting to the moon and back, that's one thing, but getting from a lunar orbit down to the surface and back, even once, is an extremely dubious position to take. But, you know, they did. I think they went to the moon. They put reflectors there and got rocks and stuff, but not the way that we think. So they hired Stanley to fake it, you know, and he, because of Dr. Strangelove and the B-52 work he did there, he got noticed by the Air Force and the Navy, and I think he was brought in 64, and they told him that they would fund, you know, a science fiction film that he could make, that he could use as R&D to create how to do the moon landings. And I think that he used front screen projection. In fact, there's a front screen projection technique to which would mean that there was a screen behind the astronauts, and that the front screen projection was projecting the background mountain scenes that you see in the Apollo pictures.
Okay.
And there's a scientist from Ukraine named Oleg Olernik, a physicist, and he used parallax, which is you take two pictures of the same area that were taking, you know, say a couple yards apart from each other, and you make a double image out of it, a 3D image out of it, and you can tell how far away the background is from the foreground by jiggling the picture and seeing if the background jiggles with the foreground. If the background jiggles with the foreground, that means the background is very close. If the background doesn't move when the foreground is jiggled or when the whole picture is jiggled, that means the background is very far away. It's called parallax. It's a thing you use in physics, also in 3D imaging in movies.
Right.
And he took Apollo 15 photographs, and all of them, the screen was anywhere from 30, or the mountain that was supposed to be, you know, 7 miles behind the astronaut was in reality about 30 meters.
Because it was perfectly in focus.
Yeah, and so Kubrick used front screen projection and other techniques.
Well, back screen projection, just I want everybody to understand, back screen projection had been used for a long time.
Yeah, but not front screen.
But not front screen. And the back screen projection is what we're used to seeing, and it looks fake.
Yeah.
You can just tell it's not right.
Well, it's always at least one stop below the front part of the picture, so the actors will be in their car driving, and you'll see the background rear screen projection is showing the what's going on in their rear window, and it always looks about one stop below what the actors are, which is totally bogus.
Right. And detectable and perceptible.
Yeah, and it really ruins movies for me all the time. Well, I hate when they use it.
Unless you're expecting it.
Well, or you use it in a surreal way, like
right,
you were getting Clockwork Orange.
Right, exactly.
Yeah, so that's all right.
So now this front screen projection, though, was Kubrick's another step in his long line of genius moves, looked real.
It did, because it projects at the same stop, the same aperture rating as the foreground objects. So there's no loss of light from foreground to background. Everything has this stunning, sameness about it. The problem is with front screen projection is that you have your person is standing, say in front of an ocean that's being projected, or say a mountain, we'll say.
Right.
And the screen is right behind the actor, say, a couple feet maybe behind him. And the problem is that they're in the same plane of focus. So unless your background image is out of focus, everything is in this kind of bizarre, everything in focus kind of thing, which you don't usually see, because lenses don't do that. And so that's kind of a dead giveaway, as that you're using front screen projection. It's one of the fingerprints. The other fingerprint is that you have to hide the bottom of the screen. So you got the screen behind the actor. If you're going to do a full body shot of your actor, you've got to have something in between to hide the bottom of the screen from being seen.
And so for Kubrick, when you look at all of these shots, and to me, once you know that, you can look and just go, come on. You can see it. There's a line always there.
Always.
In all of the shots. And
the same line is in the Apollo shot.
That's what I'm saying. And you look, and whether it's the horizon of the
ground,
right, the base of the mountains, there is always a continuous left to right breaking of top and bottom.
And a change in texture on each side.
Bingo.
Of that line. There's always different kinds of rocks, different kinds of dust and soil on the other side than there is on the front side.
Yep.
And it is just, once you see it, it actually, you start giggling.
Yeah, yeah. Like I said, you can just look and go, whatever.
Yeah,
you can see it.
You see the trick. The magician's trick is revealed. And now, you kind of really, it gives you an appreciation of how they pull the wool over us.
Because it's not that big of a room, also. So
no,
when you start
not
to look,
really.
No, it's not. It's you can do it on any sound stage, just as long as you do it correctly.
Exactly, he used other techniques besides just front screen projection. The rover scenes are done by using huge blown up pictures, which are set in a circle around your stage. And then that way you can have a roving camera, right?
Right.
And the same exact pictures of your front screen projection are just blown up to 10 feet by 18 feet.
Right, right, yeah,
and
yeah.
And then
yeah.
just stuck together. This is a technique they use in Hollywood all the time, especially in the old days. And so all this is just, it's so bogus. The whole idea that you could, the whole idea that they could go to the moon and walk around in 250 degree heat in the sunlight and 250 degree below zero in the shadows, and they've got a suit that's apparently battery powered,
right,
that has an air conditioning heating system that can control this without draining the battery in seconds.
Well, you know, and the fascinating thing right there on that subject is this. We barely, a few years ago, and everybody listening right now knows exactly what I'm talking about, we just barely have gotten into good batteries. Today.
Exactly. Like today. 5 years ago.
Yeah, 5 years ago.
Yeah, that's not, a lithium. Not a,
right. Yeah. Lithium-ion battery. Yeah. We didn't have, there wasn't, you could have had 12 car batteries on your back and it wouldn't last but for a couple, but they went up there for 3 days.
Yeah.
You know, and they didn't air condition the LEM. I'm just not buying it.
Oh, what's really funny is I knew a guy who did deep sea salvage operations and fixing like oil derricks and things, you know.
Right.
And he I was talking to him about all the Apollo stuff and he didn't know what my opinion was, but he goes, "You know, something that always bothered me about this Apollo astronauts." And I said, "Well, what's that?" And he goes, "Well, when I'm down there in the water and there's six or seven of us working, you know, we are so businesslike. We are so no-nonsense. Nobody jokes. Nobody does anything funny or prankish. And if somebody did, they would be chastised by us because it's too damn dangerous down there to be doing anything like that. And these guys are just cavorting around and bouncing around, falling on their butts." He's like, "No way. No way would they take risks like that."
Hey, I don't want to get off the subject, but I just happened to there was a hidden Twitter message here. But question, and I apologize, Eugene, for not reading this earlier. Do you was there anything with Hendaye that you found, or with Fulcanelli, about Planet X?
Well, you know, that one of the interpretations of the cross is that there's going to be four passings of some kind of planet that happened during this 26,000 year period. And it's not my interpretation, but it is one other interpretation that I've heard. So there is another person out there somewhere who thinks that there is a Planet X explanation on the cross.
You heard about the new dwarf planet that was just found beyond Pluto, right? Did you hear about that this week?
No, I did not. No.
Yeah, that's official. That's been confirmed in space.com. You can go and
oh, really?
See the photographs. Yeah, I don't think they've named it yet. But we can come up with something cool. But so that just happened. This question
Kubrick.
Came in. Oh, okay. So back to Stanley. With Bart is insisting, and you know all about Cybro,
yeah,
that nothing happened. That it was all a hoax.
It could be. I'm not going to argue with him on that.
Well, but I know that you've always been kind of in the middle.
Well, I've examined Joseph Farrell's work, and I found that he's right, and that let me tell you, the Nazis were obsessed with this group of beings that I was talking about earlier.
Right.
Hitler was obsessed with them. And he sent Nazi teams all over Tibet, all the places that where the rumors are of these people.
Right.
The Andes, Tibet,
Egypt,
North Africa.
Right.
The first place that the Italians attacked was Ethiopia, which is where the Book of Enoch was kept.
Right.
And where the Ark of the Covenant may be, by the way.
Right.
And, you know, you just see, if you look at World War II from one way, you see, oh, it's just a war where people are killing each other. But if you look at it from another way, you see it as a research and development masquerading as a war. And so what was the research and development? It was the technology which I think was given to the Nazis by these beings. Interestingly enough, former Canadian Defense Minister Paul Hillary came out about 2 months ago and said that the tall whites were not only behind the U.S. military, which they are, but they were helping the Nazis, which I was stunned to, by the way, and to hear that, especially when you realize that he is in the privy, which is the private counsel that gives advice to Queen Elizabeth.
You talking about Hellyer?
So I think the story is breaking, is what I'm saying. I think that they're releasing the information little by little.
Now, what would the for all of us that are going to go tomorrow and start watching Kubrick films?
Yep.
What are we looking for? And on top of that, why would he do it in such a way, like in The Shining? Why would he disclose it there? And why not just keep it, take it to his grave? Was he cleansing himself? Was he purifying himself?
Yeah.
I mean, is that what you think?
Yeah, it was cathartic from Clockwork Orange on.
Right.
Every single one was. I always say that there's the Kubrick career before 2001, and then there's another career after, with 2001 being the key that unlocks the whole thing. And so the before career is a career of slightly hipster, intellectual critic of society.
Right.
And the next one is a step-by-step, blow-by-blow strip-down of the Illuminati.
Do you, did it end with, was that the reason to make Eyes Wide Shut? Did he just have to finally just end the story there? Because the movie itself was kind of a weird thing for him to put out after a string of such strong movies. Eyes Wide Shut just didn't really make sense unless you were trying to get a message out of it.
Well, I think, actually, Eyes Wide Shut had at least 30 minutes cut out of it after he died. So we don't know what he really had that movie intended for. It's a hack job. I can tell you, as a filmmaker, that there's things in that movie that cannot be explained, continuity errors, dialogue, ridiculous dialogue that Stanley would have cut out.
Right.
Is left in, and it was not intended to be his last film. Stanley had already been developing the sets for the drawings for the sets for AI.
Right.
And AI was going to be Eyes Wide Shut and AI, and there was going to be a 1-2 punch. AI was going to come out in 2001, and then he was going to retire. And it was going to be the final, like, two parts of the chapters that he had to say that would finally make the other films all make sense. And
I've heard you maybe not answer this as direct as I'm going to ask it, but did The Shining even need to be a Stephen King? Could it have been any movie? And he was going to put what he had to put in
to
the movie.
I always say that Stanley Kubrick faked the making of The Shining to show you that he faked the moon landing.
Right.
So, and by the way, I talked to a friend of Stephen King's, and he told me Stephen King thought I was right.
Well, you know what? If you, it's really true. You read The Shining and you watch the movie, it's two different movies. Yeah, it's two different movies. And
two different stories.
Yeah, it truly is. Okay, so what are the let's start from the beginning. What are the let's just go down. Let's make a list. What are the dead giveaways with the messages in The Shining?
Well, it's the Shining, it starts out and first, Jack Nicholson goes and he meets the manager of the hotel, and the manager of the hotel tells Jack that, the hotel's falling apart, but he has to make it look like it's not by keeping it going during the winter, right?
Yep.
And And yes, the manager has an eagle behind him on the windowsill. And yes,
oh, in his office.
Yeah, the manager has an eagle, of course, being the Apollo 11 lander. And there's a flag there, and it does look strangely like John F. Kennedy. Then
he actually does. He does.
Yes, he does. And John F. Kennedy, by the way, wore a toupee. You can go and type it in, and you can see. I know it's shocking, but he absolutely wore a toupee.
Don't kill it for me.
He did.
Okay.
And it's just like Barry Nelson's. Anyway, and I posit the Overlook is actually America because it was built on a graveyard, of Indian graveyard, and all of the best people stayed there. And so Jack is really Kubrick, and he starts out the movie, and his hair is nice and combed, and he's shaven, and he's looking quite handsome, and he's nice to his family and everything. And about an hour into the film, Danny is playing with his trucks on the carpet in the hallway, and the markings on the hallway almost exactly match launch pad 39A, where Apollo 11 took off, including the driveway. And Danny is playing with the trucks in the
overhead shot. Yeah, you're talking about when the camera is above Danny.
Yeah.
And the pattern on the carpet is there.
Yeah, there's a pattern on the carpet. And if you Google map image of launch pad 39A in Florida, you'll see it looks pretty much just like it. You'll see all this in my movie, Kubrick's Odyssey. So Danny, is playing with these trucks, and he looks like he's a rocket sitting on the launch pad with the trucks filling up the fuel and everything, and pre-launch, right? Then all of a sudden, a ball rolls in, a tennis ball, from nowhere, and then Danny stands up, and there's an Apollo 11 sweater. He has an Apollo 11 sweater and a rocket with Apollo 11 on it taking off, going up, just like he is when he stands up.
Now, Danny, I don't think... with all of these conspiracy theories with Kubrick and the moon landings and The Shining, you can take it all and just go, yeah, whatever. But that scene with Danny with that shirt is freaky. And there's no reason. Stanley, what everybody needs to understand here, Stanley is deliberate. Everything that he does in every single shot of every single frame of every single film is done there for a reason and with purpose. And that Apollo 11 shirt is not there just because it was a shirt in wardrobe and it fit Danny that day.
Yeah, exactly. And then Danny goes down the hallway towards room 237, and the distance from the Earth to the Moon up until the laser telemetry was used in the late 70s was 237,000 miles. So Danny is symbolically taking off, traveling across the distance, and then going into a room. And it's the moon room. It's the room where they filmed the Apollo stuff, and it's Kubrick telling you that the whole thing is fake. What's interesting also in The Shining is that Jack is hiding. Remember, Jack is really Stanley. And as the movie goes on, Jack gets more and more disheveled, starts growing hair, a beard, and not shaving and not combing his hair and not changing his clothes. And this is exactly the behavior that's reported by the people in 2001 of Stanley's behavior. He started out clean shaven, and by the end of the movie, he looked like he had aged like 20 years.
Yeah, he looked like Jack Torrance at the end of...
He did.
Yeah.
Anyway, so he's hiding his writing project from his wife, Wendy, and he won't let her see what he's doing. Yet every day he's writing and writing and writing, and she hears him writing. And so one day, one night, Wendy goes into his writing room, which she's forbidden to go into, and she wants to read his book, so she does, and of course the book has the same sentence over and over: all work and no play makes Jack a dull boy. And Wendy freaks out because it's just that's what's on every single page over and over and over again, and it freaks her out that that's what Jack has been doing all day. But, and believe me, my blood ran cold when I figured this one out. But if you look at the font that is used from Jack's typewriter, you can see that the L looks just like a 1. And so you could look at it, and it says, A11 work and no play makes Jack, i.e. Stanley, a dull boy. So what it means is that his wife, Christiana, somehow discovered the project that he was hiding from her, and that project was A11, or Apollo 11. And that was the code word for Apollo 11. And there's just so many of these. And the last thing I'll say is that Stanley insisted in his contract with Warner Brothers that Eyes Wide Shut be released on July 16th, 1999. And that is exactly 30 years to the day that Apollo 11 took off.
There are no coincidences.
Nope.
Maybe.
Not this time. Anyway, it's the closest thing I've got to a smoking gun. It has done more to convince people that the moon landings are fake than I think any other research ever presented. And it's changed the way that Stanley Kubrick has been looked at.
It doesn't take away for me, or for it should be for anybody, his talent and what he has contributed to film and technology, and also the Arthur C. Clarke had a lot to do with it too as well. But the way that there still hasn't been, with all the CGI and everything else that we've got going on today, nothing looks as real as what he pulled off in 2001, which was in 1968. And so, but knowing now what I just think, I'm just going to come out and say it. Where there's smoke, there's fire. And there's just too much saying something here. And when I saw The Dark Side of the Moon, And I watched it from beginning to end, and everybody should, that's listening to this show, should watch that movie, that documentary, because you come away from that going, this is propaganda. It's funny. It's well edited. It's well acted. It's well put together. It's well written. It's shot really well. But no, they're trying to lead you away from the truth by making fun of it.
Yep.
And I'm not wrong. And when you start to look at all of this in its totality, your work, Cybrils, the CIA's work on The Dark Side of the Moon, and everything else, and then you look at the way the moon landings are shot, it feels a little funky to me. So that's it. I want to thank you, Jay, for coming on today. I've had one of the best times I've had in a long time on this show, and I hope that you enjoyed yourself too.
Well, I did. Thank you so much for having me.
And we'll talk soon. Be safe throughout the week and weekend, and I'll shoot you an email.
Yep. Watch for Shasta.
Oh. Hold on. We got 2 minutes. I can't let you get away without doing that. What is it's ShastaTheMovie.com?
Yeah, ShastaTheMovie.com. Just go there. It's my new feature film. It's about the return of Kalki Avatar, who comes from the ethers to destroy the Illuminati and bring consciousness and peace back to Earth.
When you were up, did you shoot on location?
I did.
When you were up there, now I've been up to Shasta quite a bit. As a matter of fact, I in the middle of the winter one time, driving up to Seattle, I got stuck on that road.
Yeah.
And no help at 2 o'clock in the morning. But yeah. But I'm serious. I see things when I'm up there. When you were filming up there, did some strange stuff go down?
Yeah, a lot of strange stuff. A lot of objects in the sky. We, of course, discovered some of the tunnel systems and filmed some of them are in the movie. And that place is bizarre.
It is. It really, really, really is.
Really is.
You know what? Let's do this. When Shasta gets a little bit closer, will you come back on the show and let's talk about that?
Absolutely.
Yeah, you know, like I said at the beginning of this interview, there's 8,000 points on the compass that I can go with Jay Weidner, and we only went on like 3 tonight.
Yeah.
So the invitation is there. When Shasta gets closer, come back out and let's talk about it.
Okay, man. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Jay. Have a good night.
Bye.
Bye-bye. And that's what I'm talking about. That is why you are here. I hope everybody has learned something, because I did. And again, that is Fade to Black. And I want to thank everybody tonight. We decided to, and Jay and I talked about this earlier tonight. There's going to be way too much to talk about. We didn't want to do any commercials. We didn't want to do anything. So there you go. All right. And I hope tomorrow, over the next couple of days, I want everybody to go see The Dark Side of the Moon, which is on YouTube. You can go and find it. It's there. And check that out. Now, what Dark Side of the Moon is, just so you understand, it is a mockumentary. It is the opposite of documentary. It is a mockumentary about how Stanley faked the moon landings. And Donald Rumsfeld is in the movie. Schultz is in the movie. Henry Kissinger is in the movie. Kubrick's wife, Christina, is in the movie. His original cinematographer is in the movie. And they all tell the tale about why Kubrick was selected and how he pulled it off. And they say it in a very matter. You don't know until the credits roll at the end of the movie that it's a mockumentary. It's that well done. The first time that I saw it, I'm just like, how did this movie get made? How did Donald Rumsfeld, how did Kissinger, how did George Shultz, this doesn't make any sense. And it sucks you in till the very end. Well, the only way that a movie like that can get pulled off is if somebody above all of those cats made them do it. Now, I have heard all kinds of stories about they thought they were making a movie about Nixon, they thought they were making a movie about this, and they took everything out of context. And No. Watch that movie and then get back to me. And then go and watch Jay Weidner's documentaries. There's another movie of course, Bart Seibel's, which is a funny thing happened on the way to the moon. And you start to, and there's other stuff out there too as well. There is, there's another documentary. You know what? I will get that out to you tomorrow. I don't want to brain fart at the end of the show and not remember. But I have another documentary too as well. It's a three-parter. And check that out. And when you see all of these, and you just kind of, you know what, just be, you know, be your own judge and kind of put it all together. But it's nuts. Now, back to Jay. Remember how we started off tonight? We started off with Fulcanelli and his book, The Mysteries of the Cathedral, The Mystery of the Cathedrals. And Schwaller, Lubitz, Vandenbroek, and how all of this came together. And how the book was published. There's 300 of them about alchemy and the secrets of alchemy and how they are on the 12 specific cathedrals in churches in France. And then 1952 rolls around and the last chapter of the book gets released about the cross of Hendaye, which sits in the town of Hendaye in the south of France. And the messages on that cross. All of this fits together. And it goes, and the work that Jay Weidner has done over the last 20, 25 years, which just started off with that one book that he bought at a garage sale here in North Hollywood. It's an amazing, amazing story. And that guy has done all the work for you. All you got to do is go to Sacred Mysteries and start clicking. Go search Fulcanelli and check it out. It's absolutely amazing. So, again, I want to thank everybody for coming in. I know that we're going to have a lot of email about this. A lot of it came in, Jimmy at JimmyChurchRadio.com. But this is the reason why we do this show. And tomorrow, time travel, Ron Mallett. And we'll also talk about UConn and the Sweet 16. But tomorrow, Ron Mallett. This is Fade to Black. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. I want everybody to stay tuned. Tonight,
is Night Watch, coming up next with your host, Todd Sheets. Todd and about five other hosts and a couple of guests sitting around a table. We call it the Table of Eight here at Dark Matter. Special thanks to Keith Rowland and Art Bell. Fade to Black's executive producer is Rita Kumarian. Show is produced by Hilton J. Palm and Mark D. Kovar. The announcers are Steve Harder and Mark D. Kovar. Music is Doug Aldrich. You're listening to him right now. Fade to Black is produced by KJCR for the Dark Matter Radio Network. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. I'll see everybody tomorrow night with Ronald Mallett. See ya.